Quintessential. Are we live? Is it working yet?
Is it going?
We'll wait for a couple people to join.
I can't see him.
I suppose Max knows that data.
Yeah, right.
Have these old servos all neatly laid out and everything.
So we're live, right?
We are supposedly live. We're going to wait for our moderator here to let us know for sure. So give us about 30 seconds. In case you didn't know, live is actually like 30 seconds behind.
Live on both Facebooks?
We are live on both Facebooks.
Not the YouTube yet.
Very nice.
It's like launch control.
Yeah, right?
You need one of those. We need to get one of those mics. Not the late one, downtime.
You're good.
Right. How are we looking on YouTube?
Ugly.
I'm getting there.
Fat. Ugly.
So if you're if you are watching right now and you have no idea why we're here, we are going to build slash assemble an entire Hangar 9 UltraStick 10cc. It was a smart idea we had from...
Seemed like a smart idea at the time.
Yeah. So we threw a poll out to you guys at the beginning of this week to see if this was really going to be worth the time, and it was overwhelming. A couple people internally said no. On the poll, thanks guys, you know who you are. But I think it was like 83% of you guys wanted to see this done. So we probably should mention we have cheated a bit, correct?
Not cheated, well, just the better preparation.
Yeah, look, boxes unopened, still sealed.
Yeah.
But yeah, to go back to what Carl said, we knew we had a spare Friday coming up. We knew we needed, Carl wanted to do for the insider segment of Horizon Videos, he wanted to do another ARF build because you did the carbon cup.
Yep.
ARF build, which was super popular.
Yeah, that was already a year ago.
A year already?
Yes.
Okay. So, yeah, he wanted to do that. And between the three of us, we came up with the idea of let's do something different. Let's use that downtime and try and do a Hangar 9 build slash assembly, because I know somebody's going to comment and say, this isn't really a build. So, with say assembly, build's just easier to type.
Yeah.
And yeah, here we are.
Yep.
Three of us, relatively newbies to ARF assembly, not so much a newbie to ARF assembly, and Hangar 9 10cc UltraStick, one of our best-selling aeroplanes, been around, the UltraStick design has been around forever. This aeroplane is probably a couple of years old from memory in terms of us releasing it, and the Hangar 9 workshop space on a quiet Friday. So,
So we have prepped and centered servos. What else have we done?
Made sure the controller had the right fittings on to fit the E-Flight motor, because obviously when this motor was released, we didn't have the smart controllers. We want to use the smart Avian, I believe, ESC in this, so they're already prepped. Other than that, it's totally sealed. We're going to see how long it's going to take us to build. So if anyone wants to throw a prediction out there in how many hours it will take, or days, let us know.
Hopefully less than 4 hours, because that's all we can go live on Facebook with.
Is that it? Is that a limit?
Yeah.
Oh, better stop talking.
The last thing, while they start opening this up, we are...
The reason why I recommended the two servo wing, or the full span aileron, as opposed to the flapping aileron, I prefer it. Genuinely, the UltraStick 30cc with flap and aileron is great. It has the versatility of the crow, which this does as well. You can use crow mixing when the flaps come down and ailerons go up. I just prefer the lighter wing, lower rolling inertia. So I know you want to use this aeroplane to take your flying to the next level. So you've got the carbon cub with flaps and so forth. For this, I want to get you doing the rolling stuff. So the less weight we can have in the wings, the better.
Yeah. So, also, I'm going to jump out of the way and move. So, we have three streams going. We have the Hangar 9 Facebook, which is actually on this phone that I'm picking up here. So, we're actually going to take this and do a lot of the detail stuff. So, if you guys are really interested in seeing, like, the up-close and personal stuff, that's going to be what this stream is for. So, Hangar 9 Facebook page. We also have the Horizon Hobby Facebook going right now. And then, of course, if you're on YouTube, we have your video as well. But if you really want to see the up-close and personal stuff, this is the camera right here. So we'll probably kind of have a couple different angles going on as well.
And if you have any questions, Max is moderating for us, so please put questions in. If there's any areas you want to see specifically whilst we're doing them, please put a question in. Max will fire them across to us, and if we have time, which I'm sure we will, we can address those questions immediately.
I don't know. We're one wrong measurement away from disaster at all times. Or one bag of epoxy.
All right.
One wrong CA point by Kyle.
Nah, yeah, just for the record, I thought this was a terrible idea, but we're going along with it.
Look, it was either me hold Carl's hand through the build like I did with the carbon card, or get you involved as well. So I figure we operate a no blame culture, you're involved. So I've set some loose tasks up for each of us, yep. So we're not stepping over each other. Carl, if you could start with the wing, doing hinge points, the Sino hinges, yep. And so forth. Pete, if you could get on the undercarriage. I'm going to do probably the most time-consuming part, I think, of the build. And it's only time-consuming because it involves epoxy drying, which is gluing the stab on.
So we are actually going to use the manual. That's one thing that we do stress a lot.
We are.
Pete and I will be using the manual and marking off what we've done. That way we're not backtracking and getting scrambled and mixed up as
well. I put hundreds of minutes into hours into that manual. So yeah.
So if there's any typos or anything, it's definitely you.
Yeah. America's not my first language, so yeah, don't hold it against me.
Oh, I got to talk about our snacks too.
Our snacks.
We have snacks.
Not that he's easily distracted. Stage one.
Snacks. What's the step one in building an airplane?
Snacks. Dude, I gave you a Ferrero Rocher already. What would you want?
So, I got a couple stick-themed snacks for us to munch on throughout the video.
That's why he was late to the fest.
Yeah, he was. Yep.
I knew it.
So we have Twizzlers.
Yeah.
Pretzel sticks.
Nice work, sir.
Veggie sticks. That's for Allie. Some meat sticks.
Trying to build here.
Oh, yeah. Assemble, sorry.
And Twinkies.
Let's Twinkies. Do it. So, interesting point. Already distracted with doing a live. I made the first mistake.
Uh-oh. What'd you cut?
Nothing. No, I haven't cut. That's the good news. I actually checked before I cut. it's only where I've marked the stabs. Now, to do this 100% properly, I'd be measuring the stab either side and triangulating it to a front point to make sure we're dead straight as far as stab alignment's concerned. But I think in this case, given the time we have, I'm going to have to go with the old eyeball.
So Alex, we got Jeremy asking why there's no longer a smaller stick. He says he's got a 40 size converted to electric. Mm-hmm.
Vendors, simply put. Our vendors are such now, that was made at a vendor that has gone away, shut their doors, no longer produces wooden ARFs. And the vendors we do have, it's quite difficult to make a wooden ARF aeroplane of that size nowadays that is price competitive. With foam technology coming on as far as it has, difficult to justify the difference between a small wooden aeroplane costing X amount and a foam one costing Y amount when they're so similar in price. And believe it or not, it's actually not much cheaper to make a tiny stick compared to this one. It's the same materials, it's the same, well, almost the same materials, it's the same construction technique, so yeah, it's a price driven thing.
So that was Jeremy on Hangar 9.
Cool.
Thanks for the question, Jeremy.
We got Brad on HH asking if that's a one-piece wing straight out of the box.
It is, yeah. You saw us unpack it. When I developed this aeroplane, I wanted the one-piece wing for simplicity and lightness. I don't know. If hindsight, if I did it again, I'd go with two-piece because you'd be surprised how much a two-piece wings add in terms of weight. If I could maybe redesign the structure so it could be lighter yet retain the same strength, I'd go with two piece, but right now I'm super happy it's one.
Is the 30 a one piece wing?
No, 30 is a two piece wing. Again, you've got more size, more wing area, so you can carry that little bit more weight on the 30 without an issue. The smaller airplanes are, the more critical it is in terms of wing loading.
Hey Gary.
So I'm peeling back the covering here on the horizontal stabilizer. The reason for doing this is pretty self-explanatory, but I'll go through it anyway whilst I'm doing it, is to make sure this glues to the wooden plate on the fuselage. If I just applied epoxy onto this shiny covering and glued it on, whilst it may feel like it's adhered, it would pop off pretty much straight away. So by removing the covering, I expose the bare wood and have a much better bonding surface. Now, when I was doing that, one of the things to notice was I was very careful with how I cut the covering. It would be super easy at that stage to have cut this covering really heavy-handedly and cut into the wood. And what that would do is create a weak point, a stress riser, as some people call it. Let's call it a weak point. Even that score in the covering can cause a point where the elevator or the stab cracks under load. So I was super light when I cut it. And just as a belt and braces thing, I tend to, this is just a personal thing, run some thin CA on top of that cut. One, to get the covering a little bit more stuck down. So when I come to shrink this, which you can see the wrinkles, it doesn't peel back as much. And more importantly, it's just to fill that gap that I may have put in inadvertently with my knife cut.
Yeah, and I'll show everyone with the Hanger 9 cam here the difference between the, I guess I should say, the full span A-lines, which I'm kind of making sure they're correct, and then the ones we just pulled out here.
Allie, we've got a couple guys asking why we're doing electric instead of gas.
Simplicity, speed, and practicality for Kyle at the field. So he did gas on the carbon cup, 15cc.
The second time around.
Oh, yeah, I wanted him to use this with electric. Oh, again, I want to teach him how to 3D, some basic prop hanging stuff, some harriers, and the electric system is a little bit more efficient in terms of how to weight than the gas on the 10cc.
And simplicity for this build process too, because I don't know if I want to say it out loud just yet, but we're hoping by the end of this live to actually give you guys a test flight.
Ah, that's an optimistic hope, considering one, how much time we've got, two, where we're located.
Yeah.
Never say no.
It is actually extraordinarily nice out for it being January.
For Illinois.
It's snowing. It's like,
it's not snowing.
It snowed, sorry. There's snow on the ground.
Yeah.
It's extraordinarily nice. This is the
Floridian. If you've ever watched Allie in any video talk about the temperature, add 20 degrees and reduce the amount of precipitation he's talked about in half as well.
Why? Just because I'm from the UK?
No, because you exaggerate a little bit.
Never. Told you a million times. So, same as what I just did with the horizontal stab, the fin. I have marked up with a pencil. I use a pencil just because it's a hand and it's easy to wipe off the mark. That gives me an area where it's going to actually bond to. Now, with that in mind, this camera, right? It's a Hanger 9 camera. Correct?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. With that in mind, you can see you can see the pencil line. I want to be cutting inside of that. So if I cut dead to that pencil line, what would happen is you'd have exposed wood showing, which isn't great. So it's just a visual thing, it's not a structural thing, and that exposed wood will get worse as the covering pulls back with heat. So what I'm going to do is generally cut, about an eighth of an inch in. That last eighth won't make much of a difference in terms of bonding strength, but it will make a lot of difference in the aesthetic, the visual aesthetic. Same on the fin itself. You see, that's the line where the fuselage top side is. If I cut just to here, you'd get that nasty bit of exposed wood, as opposed to here, cutting inside, so it's all sunken into that area there. Enough talking, let's get going. Same deal as I did with the horizontal stab, try not to put too much pressure onto the knife cut. If it takes a couple of cuts, brand new sharp blade is essential for this, otherwise you will be cutting through the covering and into the balsa below, which will affect the strength of this key part here. There are no flying wires or bracing wires on the vertical or horizontal stab on the Ultra Stick, so you really are relying on the strength of this. Nice thing about this vendor, I learned very early on that the samples of this, well, in fact the 30cc Ultra Stick came with a soft balsa tail group. They did that to keep the weight down, so we had a lighter tail end than would be achieved if it was all hardwood. The problem with that was it was quite fragile, so now they put a ply insert. I probably can't see it on the camera, but it's a balsa wood outer with a light ply inner, so it's a fair bit stronger.
I like how we have like skill level going down. I'm on the much more pedestrian task of installing the axles and the wheels, and I'm almost ready. Got the pants going on here.
You're about done then, huh?
Essential, yeah. Essential task, Pete. You can't be flying it without undercrackers.
This is true.
So what are your guys' predictions for time-wise?
Today.
I know it'll be done today, Alex.
Yeah. Today. I don't know. This is all new to us. So. Oh, of course it's here.
Oh, no.
James Haley.
This is bad.
How's it going, guys?
Hey.
Don't ask him that, Pete.
Yeah, you just engaged him. Now they have to talk.
The whole world wants to see you guys, I'm sure.
This is what you I can help. Work. I'm good at this.
All the bosses are here. Jeez. So, we really are in trouble.
Who approved this?
You did.
Need a hole somewhere?
According to that PO, you did.
Oh, okay.
But Carl did get that signature
Steve
without...
Steve says, don't let the heli guy touch anything.
That's all right, heli guys.
That's Allie. Allie's a heli guy. Hey, you got Twinkies over here.
Look at that, distraction.
That's all our stick themed snacks.
Oh, this is a filled buffalo.
Bunch of champions over there.
For our stick build.
Yep. Oh, well. Allie, where are your small drill bits?
Hey, I just gotta throw this out there, this won't work.
What? Well, that'll get taken care of.
That's the car guy did that.
Use the right amount of heat shrink. Yeah. Read the manual.
Twist and tight.
So you're getting this done on one filming?
No, it's three filming.
Oh, three. No,
that's
there's
the point.
Three cameras, but
one effort.
Yeah.
One effort, one shot.
One shot wonder.
All right.
I've seen the level of build quality that comes out of these type of things.
I have too.
Yeah.
My own personal airplane.
Hold on a second.
Yeah.
Are we taking abuse from Haley?
No. He has just seen the
from Mr. Hot Glue,
the group Stuka build,
yeah,
and the frightful
the X Cup survived.
Everything survived.
Stuka survived.
Yeah, it just took James and I 6 more hours to correct everything.
Oh, here we go.
The heli guy had to fix.
There was no warranty on that build,
except for when the wheel
put all the developers in one room.
I don't know whether to, I'm going to hold it for 5 or 3.
Using 5-minute epoxy?
Thrilling content.
Yeah, I'm just for the video.
It's like watching.
I used the two hardness.
Two hardness.
That means it dries quicker, doesn't it?
Yeah, right. So, question, your drill bits aren't labeled. Is that a good size to drill the hole to wick the hinges?
Yeah, anything to let the cyno run in, so that's fine. I'd go with multiple holes if you can.
Okay.
Just to be sure. So what Carl's doing there, everyone, it's a key part of using a cyno hinge. These are CA cyno hinges. There's different types of hinges. You have the pin hinges, which are put in with epoxy. The CA hinges are quick, light, super durable, but they need to be applied properly. And the biggest part of that is putting this hole here, the pilot hole, for the glue to wick down into the actual hinge gap. A lot of people I've seen don't use this hole. What happens is the CA sits on top of the surface, and of course the surface is this nice shiny ultra coat. Doesn't stick to that, it really doesn't. So what Carl's doing by putting the hole in will ensure that cyno gets into the right place.
So we got Joe on Horizon asking what prop we're using and what prop
gray one
recommended. One that spins.
We're using the one from the recommended
APC
manual.
APC 14x8.5E.
I've only just noticed Haley's had a haircut at last.
Yes! Who made that happen?
Was that an executive order? Dustin, did you make it?
There was a comment.
No, who's it, Dearden? Yeah, Dearden's like, you need a haircut. I'm like,
Jane said something too.
No, that was after I got a haircut.
So again, if we had time, all the cameras, if we had time when we're doing this 100% properly, I'd have this lined up with 30 minute epoxy so I could put the wing on and measure and get everything aligned. But
how's the Kyle doing?
I'm pretty sure I can use an eyeball that's built quite a few airplanes and get it set up. Super easy with the ultra stick as well because it's a box type fuselage. So I've got the 90 degrees of the base of the fuselage on both sides. So yeah. Don't try this at home, the usual deal. So you like that, James?
I'm good, I'm taking that airplane.
No, you're not.
Yeah, it is.
Good luck.
I'll bring a heli in and I'm taking
it. No, I don't want to. You have more than one heli for that airplane, bro.
Okay, 4, 3, I got 2 on my
basis. Get Dustin to sign off and make a batch.
Are we allowed to talk about what plane they're talking about?
I have admin rights now, man.
Done. Make it happen.
Do we need to flip the hangar night cam around?
Nah, they'll see it at one point or
if
another.
If only these people saw what these folks were looking at right now.
Yeah. So we've had to be on our best behavior to strip the workshop, because normally I've got airplanes in here that are probably 18 months, maybe sometimes 2 years out in development terms, so they've all had to be hidden away. Unfortunately, James Haley just saw one of the ones I've left out over there and is trying to take it home with him.
David's asking what amp ESC we're using.
The 60 amp.
60 amp smart.
Yes.
Yeah, when I developed this project, we didn't have smart technology ESCs, so it was suggested to be set up with the E-Flight 60, I believe. The smart tech.
It just unlocks a lot more we can do after the fact.
Yeah.
Oh, Ali, Ian from England saying hi.
Hello, Ian.
Hey, this one that you hit back here looks nice.
That's the one with the wings.
Which
right?
one would that be, Dustin?
The one with a wing.
How many wings?
How many wings does it have?
A wing?
I don't know. It just looks really good.
You like it? What do you like about it the most, Dustin?
The color?
I like everything about it. If it disappears, don't look at my house.
Well, that's okay. The one that's cub yellow, right?
Yep.
No, it's the P-51.
Ah.
Oh, it's the cub yellow P-51. Dustin saw it. Oh, no.
Oh. Alan.
Take that knob a little bit, it won't fall over.
Go.
Al, we got Jeremy asking if there was ever a full-span aileron made for the 30cc
No, because you can mix it together very easily. I figured that the majority of the people flying the larger stick would have a radio that had capability to mix the four servos together. So you can have full-span aileron on the 30cc, just not mechanically like you can on this one.
So Jeremy, that was the answer to your comment there on Hangar 9.
How many viewers do we have right now, Matt?
We're at 112 on Horizon Facebook. We are at 68 on Hangar 9 Facebook and 27 on R29 on YouTube.
Nice. Thank you guys for joining. Hopefully we can keep you entertained the whole time.
Oh, no, I think more snacks need to be busted out.
No, slow down productivity. So I've done the 5 minutes epoxy gluing of the horizontal stab. Now I'm on to the vertical. Whilst the epoxy isn't fully set at 5 minutes, it'll be enough to hold it in place.
Kyle, it looks like you're gluing hinges. What glue are you using?
Just Zap
Thin
CA.
Other CAs are available.
Yes. You pretty much have to use the thin, correct me if I go off rogue here.
Oh, have to. Yeah,
doing the CA hinge to get, you need the CA to go all the way down and wick the entire hinge.
Yeah. I'm sure people are enjoying me just trying to find what tool I need in your toolbox.
Why don't you just ask me, Pete?
Opening and closing drawers.
Pete's over here with two.
You guys do your thing.
This is what Pete has found. All the tools we have, he has two adjustable wrenches.
That was one's metric, one's imperial. That was the two perfect tools to put the axles on.
Left and right.
Yep.
So luckily, the camera is on me. I was just about to say, luckily the camera isn't on me watching how much of a mess I'm making applying this epoxy.
The good news, it's only 5 minutes, so.
Ali, Benko is asking if the Sato FG11 is enough to power this Ultra Stick.
It's a question we get asked quite a lot, and not specifically towards the FG11, it's is it enough to power it? And that's open to interpretation. It's by what standards you want it to be powered. Could I fly it with the FG11?
Yes.
Would it be wildly aerobatic with the FG11? No. So if you are looking for a sport cruiser to go club flying and doing the odd loop and swoop, yes. If you're looking to prop hang it and do some 3D stuff with it, no. Nitroforce, can't build without this stuff. Cleaner that we sell from Dynamite is superb. It just, I'm using it to wipe off the epoxy that I spilled everywhere.
We got Steve on YouTube saying he's watching two streams.
Whoa.
Yeah.
Whoa.
That's
risky.
He's probably got some echo in his house right
probably
now.
Probably a little bit.
The bummer about that is that means it's actually one less person that
I just saw that.
So, Ali, you bring up a good point. Have all your cleaning chemicals and supplies ready. Correct?
Essential, yeah, definitely, definitely. At this stage, when we work into a timeline like we are as well with 5-minute epoxy, yeah, it's essential.
Allie, Jeremy's calling you out on your little epoxy job right there.
Oh man, I knew someone's gonna see that.
It says it looks like a swap meet plane.
Oh, that's harsh. Wait until the end result.
It's brand new.
Yeah, we're on a deadline here. Swap meet plane. You didn't see the dynamite nitro force in action. It's making it look like a concourse winner. Beautiful lines it brings out in this sweet thing. Whew. Just need to put that down, a bit of heat, that'd be all right. Yeah, please don't expect Top Gun winning build standards here. We are working to a very tight timeline. But that's no excuse for shoddy workmanship. So yeah, I blame my work colleagues for the shoddy workmanship.
You blame us for your shoddy workmanship?
Yep.
Okay.
Come on, Pete, you work with me on the fly, you know how it works. It's always the cameraman's fault.
Yep.
Right, that's that. So the tell group's drying. Literally, I'm going to move the camera because I swore that we weren't going to have a camera of 5-minute glue drying. We can come back whilst that's going on. Pete, what are you up to?
Just finishing off these bullet connectors, putting a little bit more heat shrink on them.
The ones Kyle did half.
Yeah.
Why?
Didn't get them all the way done. So I was. I just finished the gear. The gear's ready to get installed. But yeah, I was getting prepared because then we're going to put the motor on, put the motor mount on, so we can get this out of the way real quick while we're getting towards that.
Kyle, drying time on those cyano hinges.
Almost immediate, all right. So you got to be ready. So that's one thing that I think the manual differs probably. I know it did with the Cub, is we actually put it in the control surface first,
yep.
Glue it up, and then you can actually use that, slide in your hinge, mark the centers of where you're going to drill, that way you can line up where the glue is actually going to drip in and wick. So that's what I was just, if you saw me making the little tiny marks on here, boom, 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 boom.
That's really, really a wise move, because I've done it before where the hinge is all the way to one side and I drill the hole and it's actually not lined up with the hinge point. So yeah, it's a good bit of advice from the ARF newbie there.
I think someone probably told me that.
Ali, I would assume we're going to have to put some pilot holes in this for...
Yes, there should be a drilling mount, a template mount somewhere.
Okay.
I believe...
There you go.
Look at that. Right here?
Yeah.
Beautiful. Oh, nice. And that just pops right over the nose, right?
That's the idea, yeah.
Beautiful. There.
I'm not taking all the credit for that, but that was all my idea.
And then that's pretty cool.
For a while, but yeah, I always had a problem with mine taping them on or holding them, so yeah, we now have a plywood edge, so.
That's really cool, so yeah, just this template pops right on here, and then you just follow the little legend here of which holes you need. So we're gonna do a power, it's the power 52, not the power 46, but they come on the same mount.
Just double check, I would, but yes, they are the same X mount, so
cool.
Always before drilling, it's one of those things. Measure twice, drill once or whatever, so yeah. I'm gonna do it.
Or if you're Gary, you drill four times, then measure.
I only said
that because Gary's back here.
That was a less than subtle dig at our the Gaz over there, which may have been building a sample aeroplane during the week, which has a few lightning holes in it that maybe shouldn't have.
You gotta get it right six times, not four.
Oh yeah. I'm going to do some housekeeping because I can't work in this mess.
Perfect, yep. So that, just to make sure that that motor mount does work perfectly, so I'll go ahead and get some pilot holes drilled.
Yeah.
Would this drill work too, or is that too small? Need a bigger...
It's good for a pilot. Yeah.
Okay.
How big a battery
are
you
going to
put in there? Cells?
6S3200, I believe.
Really?
Yep.
The small top.
Yeah. This one. Gray one.
The gray one.
The gears are already turning, aren't they?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Somewhere shooting. Look at that undercracker's all done by Petey, isn't it?
Gary's going to have it worked out how quickly this is going to be back on the ground before we even take off.
You checked the direction of these bolts, right?
I did, actually.
Pete, I would have had that assembled the wrong way, guaranteed. 50-50 chance you can get it assembled the right or the wrong way.
I would have nailed it the wrong way.
Mary's saying this workshop looks pretty clean compared to hers.
Yeah, I don't do well working in a messy environment. So try and keep it as clean as possible.
Drill keeps dying on me.
Uh-oh.
What's dying, the drill?
Yeah.
That's Gary Wright. He was doing it during the week.
Do you have another battery by chance here?
Nope.
Okay.
We got another drill.
Cool.
We have the foam guy's drill, which I borrowed. Whilst you're doing that, I'm going to roughen the elevator joiner. So, Max, this joiner here means that we can use one elevator servo for driving both elevators. It's a metal U-shaped joiner that goes between the left and the right side. Epoxy's in here. Now, I can just epoxy it straight in there if I want to. It's probably definitely wiser to roughen the gluing area on this shiny metal. It will be, one, have no texture to adhere to, and probably some oil and release agent in there. So what I will do, I'll put it in there.
So you're just going to use some Scotch-Brite or some sandpaper to toughen that out?
Dremel. Dremel's quicker, but anything will work. So I'm just marking it there. Marking it there. I don't need to do the bit in between there, so... Yeah, I'm lazy when it comes to using a power tool. I'll always go for that option, so...
Meanwhile, we have the first... looks like the right aileron glued in. I'm just working the joint a little bit. That way it doesn't get overly hard, then you kind of have to break it. So I think we're good. We'll also give this a tug or two, probably on each joint, just to make sure that it is properly adhered.
About how long do you think that took you?
What I just did here? 15 minutes. Probably would have been faster if we weren't distracted and live, but this does have, I mean, you gotta think, we eliminated the aileron control surface and the flap, each of which has three hinges, so we basically just did six hinges all at once. So, there's six joints, not really six hinges.
I don't know if the camera will show up, Max, but there is one side that has been roughened, that side there, and that side which is smooth, so that's a... to me a really important part, because without that you get no adhesion. It just goes in and will be friction holding it in after a short time. So, and what I'll do with that is probably get the nitroforce or our methylated spirits alcohol to clean the dust off that as well. So these are things, although we're rushing, you know, and if I really wanted to do this quickly, I would sino this in that hole and get it done. It's really not worth skimping on these bits. You know, whilst I didn't measure the stab, these are the sort of things that can cost you an aeroplane, so, yeah, take your time is what I'm trying to say.
What part is that?
It's the elevator joiner.
Okay. I really didn't know.
Allie, I would just need a drill bit that would match these. Got my pilots done, just need to make a bigger hole so these slide.
You can tell when some of us are doing an important focus task because they stop talking.
Yeah, it's nice and quiet.
Mm-hmm.
Is that a good thing?
I don't know. It means we're focused on our work, right?
It's probably not good for them, but
yeah,
the oversized, that'd be good.
Yeah, so keep the questions coming, the comments coming.
One thing this has brought home to me and reminded me, Max is laughing.
We got an assembly, not a build guy on here.
Hey!
That's what we were waiting for.
Okay. What is the definition? Do we need to get into that?
I don't think we need to start that argument.
No?
Because Gary will get involved and then it'll just be a whole...
He just scooted back again.
Well, Gary's alright.
Gary has entered the chat.
He said when he's doing a sample that he is building a sample, so...
You need sandpaper and a covering iron in order to cover the field.
Sandpaper, albeit rotary, and I will be covering iron these wrinkles out, so... Yes!
Okay.
Gary Wright says it's a build.
So, Allie, I have a question for you. So, I'm kind of eyeballing these to make sure that before we glue them,
one sec.
The slot exists. So as you come down the line, you kind of see this one's good, this one's good, this one's good, this one's good.
You haven't glued that one in, right?
No.
Oof. Hey, Pete, David's asking this if one, a 6S5000.
You can't quite get it far enough from the control surface to match up. So would we slit this bigger or this bigger to make it slide a little bit more?
Really doesn't matter.
Okay.
Honestly, they're both open structure surfaces. Inside there is an open structure. So yeah, whichever is convenient for you, Carl.
Okay. Yeah, because the rest are spot on.
Good.
Let's see. You said this one with the blade? No.
Okay.
Hey, Craig.
Hi. Oh, it's getting serious now. Craig Greening.
Hi.
Product development, field marketing manager. All sorts of roles at Horizon this man
supervisor.
Has.
Supervisor.
There you go. Critique. Famous for his critique, hint at work. Never one to hold back on his opinion.
You're describing you or Craig?
Whoa! He was my mentor when I joined the company. Believe it or not, when I joined, I was really mild. Not opinionated, I was just super calm with my thoughts and opinions. He taught me everything I know.
Almost done. Yeah, we're looking quite mad.
Everywhere, all around.
Watermelon's coming together.
We got Jeremy on Hangar 9 asking, what's going to happen to this plane when you guys are done building?
So the idea of this airplane is, as I said, we want to get Kyle doing some more advanced flying with the wooden ARF. He's had a lot of sick time, actually, on the 15cc carbon cup. I'd like to get him doing a bit more advanced aerobatics. So, all being well, we should see some follow-up videos. I'd like to actually do a video with Kyle as well on programming of the 637 receiver. We're going to put the new AR637, which is fully programmable from the radio, so we could set up AS3X. We could even set up SAFE on this from the radio, I believe. So, yeah, plenty of content is basically what I'm trying to say, Jeremy. You'll see this thing flying hopefully in the spring and maybe even with a set of floats in the summer. It's all down to that man over there. not that man. He's our cameraman. And our cameraman and quad flying expert. So if you ever see any of our on the fly footage, that's pretty much all down to Pete. Not only the quad flying, but also the camera work and the editing work. So
the behind the scenes guy.
What you got there, Craig?
You want some snacks?
Unobtainable at the moment. AR-637T, fantastic new six-channel receiver, AS3X and SAFE on board.
If I'm not mistaken, that's our first forward programmable SAFE and AS3X receiver, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah. So if you have the right transmitter, everything can be set up direct from TX2 device.
I think we
saw it.
Coming soon.
Yeah.
We have its friend available, but not that one just yet.
Pete, Paul says you've been pretty quiet, but you seems like you're getting things done.
Exactly. Don't somebody's got to do something around
that's
here.
That's Pete's MO.
What motor is
that? Power 52. I should be doing some work.
I just told Pete we must be doing a bad job because you're like just hanging out, chilling.
That was always the idea. Now let's get you guys going. I'm leaving soon anyway. It's 20 past one on a Friday afternoon, Carl. Wow.
Even worse.
You guys have not seen me here on a Friday afternoon for at least a week. Craig, tell us more about your role at Horizon. What do you... I know you're a master of all trades, but what do you
master of something?
What do you do on a daily basis?
Well, I've been here a while, and when you came, I think I was still in product development, right? But the last 3 years, I've been taking care of Team Horizon, which is our field reps. A lot of people call them, representing our Horizon and our brands in the field, supporting customers from the technical side, displaying and demonstrating products. On top of that, we've added some things to my role, so I now look after the Horizon Hobby Flight School, as well as our brand ambassador group. So
I see the brand ambassador is growing a lot, right?
Yeah, we're adding more and more people. We have applications out there. We're still taking applications. It takes a while to get through them. We get a lot of those, but we're adding people every week. Always looking for people who just love the hobby to be part of the brand ambassador group for us.
Gotcha.
And if you guys didn't know, if you love the Valiant and all flavors of the Valiant.
Oh my gosh, hold on, Pete.
Yep.
Do you want to show us some candlelight and some music?
It's almost Valentine's
Day. The Valiant creator.
Yeah, he is.
Claim to fame.
I'll give him that.
So cool.
Okay. And personally, yourself, I know you're a very keen RCist hobbyist. It's not even just RCist. Right. You've taken quite a detour the last couple of years.
I've been doing this a long time, but the last couple of years, seriously into free flight. So back to what the roots of the hobby, I guess. And
where a lot of us started, right?
I love it. But free flight's come a long way. Literally, but recently, a lot of technology involved, so that's fun.
Crazy to think the simplest part of the hobby is now, and I've watched stuff that you've been doing.
From that, you know, the power side to the timing units, which are electronic, some incorporate GPS. I'm using Spectrum components in some of my models for various functions. Electric power, glow, gas. No power, we do gliding as well. It's a lot of fun, I really enjoy it.
And it's competitive, right? Mostly
competitive. So that limits it a little bit. You need big spaces, as you're aware.
Yeah,
a lot of fun. Huge amount of fun.
And before that, what were you doing in the RC side of things? I know they were quite specialist, the areas that you focused upon.
A lot of sailplane competition, some pylon racing, both three pole and then giant scale racing as well.
And that's the 150cc and above scale pylon racers that are doing over 200 mile an hour, right?
Yeah, quarter scale up to almost half scale models doing over 200. Nice. Yeah, it's just crazy stuff.
And then you went to F3K, is it? The spinny F3K, round and throw up in the air?
Don't do much of that anymore, but I did that for a long time.
So if anyone's wondering, Mr. Greening doesn't do much in the middle ground, okay? He goes from extreme to extreme and then to extreme. 200 miles an hour to spinny round to no control. Just throw it and hope.
Right. I have one of these. I have an interesting.
Yeah, when was the last time you flew it?
Last year. It's been a little while.
And by the way, he doesn't mean December.
Last June, I would say. I love it. Super fun model. I'm excited to see this one come together. I went old school on mine though. No electric.
Glow, right?
Yeah, Sato Glow. There four you go. Stroke, Sato 62.
Rocking the old school.
It smells great.
Yeah, I agree. There's always that pang of nostalgia when you're running a Glow engine.
Yeah.
Cool. Any questions, Max?
We got one from Craig on Horizon Facebook.
That's me.
That's you. Told you, he's a man of many talents.
He asks why you're gluing the hinges one side at a time. He says he always glues them.
Solid question.
Oh, I think we talked. You're talking about the control surface and then the wing.
I'm pretty sure.
Or just left, right.
I'm pretty sure he's asking about the control surface and the wing.
So the reason we were doing that was so that. Personally, that's just kind of something we did during the 15cc, my first ARC build.
It's actually in the manual, if you look.
Really?
Yeah, you're supposed to put a pin in there, and the idea is that you get them dead center.
So, get them center, glue it, and then, actually the step I'm about to do now is I can actually slide the whole surface in, bend this back, and then mark with the, you know, the little felt tip pen where the center of the joint's going to be. That way I know I can drill that, and then glue it, and it wicks a little bit better.
Cool.
So that was Craig on Horizon Facebook.
So one thing I'm learning about today is it's bringing back nostalgia for me, because when I was in England a few years ago, I always used to build in a group. It was much more fun than building individually. It's more social, I find. There's more banter that goes on. It's more fun. But what I'm realizing now is I need to do this every day. I did like 5 minutes worth of work, glued two bits together, and this plane's coming together without any involvement with me.
Just always do your builds on the log, right?
So guys, we've got new samples arriving for Hangar 9 next week. So if you want to come swing past, maybe Friday morning,
feel free.
Yeah. So Ali, I know we really can't answer this question, but Duncan is asking on Hangar 9 if we have any new releases coming out this year.
Yes.
Okay. You answered the question.
And Ali, the back of your head is being looked at on
a whoa, the spot. Sorry about any reflection.
Thanks, Max. All right. Yes, we will always have new releases in development. The development process of a Hangar 9 airplane takes in the region of 12 months to 24 months. So we're working on airplanes right now for 2021.
I don't think so.
There will be one forthcoming in the not too distant future. I know that we are proofing a manual right now on a new airplane. It's a so that's we're normally the final stages. So if you're bored, Max, there's a.
I need a better driver for it.
One of the pages is a manual. Good.
Yeah.
Feel free to prove it.
All right.
The little drill bit.
What you after?
That little
what, the one that's in the drill.
In this that drill. One. Yeah, because this one stopped working.
That's right. Craig. I'm holding it.
I thought you were going to do a pull test. I was like, I already did. No, go for
I need the little drill bit. I got sidetracked talking.
Three out of four are done, guys.
You're amazing, Pete. Honestly.
Almost ready.
You are my hero. We couldn't do this with you. Wait. As I say, Pete, often you don't appreciate it, but there is no beginning to your talents.
You're such a sweetheart.
I know, right?
Such a nice guy, this Mr. Machichi.
Oh, easy now. Don't hear that often unless I'm in trouble. Carl, what are we going to do about servos? Don't say put them in. We're going to put them in the back, or we're going to put them in the fuselage?
I think we determined we were going to put them in the back, and then logic took over and said, well, we're going electric, we're not going to have a ton of weight up front. It'll probably be easier to manage the CG if we put them up front.
Okay.
So maybe we should bring that up for people who don't know that you have the option.
That's maybe where I was going with this. Go on, then.
I don't know if you've been talking a lot. So the cool thing about both the 10cc and the 30cc UltraStick is you can put the rudder and elevator servos in the back or up front in the fuselage, correct?
Yeah. The name of the game with this airplane was versatility, and with that in mind, there were two servo positions spec'd out from when it was produced. One in the conventional place, which is underneath the wing, inside the fuselage, using long metal push rods. The other one was right in the back end and pretty much in front of the control surface itself. There's different schools of thought as to which one's better. Obviously, bringing them forward moves the weight forward, so if you have an aeroplane that is inherently tail heavy, then having them in the fuselage makes sense. Vice versa, if you use the big glow or gas engine on the front of this aeroplane, to have the ability to put the servos in the back end would be very, very beneficial, because you then wouldn't have to counteract the heavy gas engine with dead weight or lead.
Ali Chris says he can relate to the shiny spot on the back of your head. Yeah. You guys want to?
It's taken me ages to develop it, Chris, but thank you. Thanks for relating.
So those are already glued on that one side? Is that what
they weren't
you're talking about? They weren't?
No.
Are they now?
Oh, no. Yeah.
Okay.
Looks like we got a couple people jumping like across streams.
Uh-huh. That's
cool. Mary from YouTube is now on our Hangar 9 stream. A couple more people have jumped across.
Good.
Kind of getting this other aileron hooked up.
How long we got?
Yep. One of the hinges is a little sticky, now, right? So I'm just trying to make sure it's not going to
load. So have you glued them yet, or you kind of just test fit and everything?
So we're glued into the control surface, but not the wing itself.
So just making sure everything moves freely?
Yeah, because
this one hinge here is catching a little bit, so I think I'm going to open up that a little bit.
That's the same with me. Whenever I order them, I eat one and that's it.
Pete, what do you got going on over there? Getting motor screws in?
Yep, still working on it.
You've been doing that for about 15 minutes.
Oh, don't listen, Pete.
How many screws hold that in? A dozen, or?
I'll trade you jobs.
Oh, here we go.
Now, I had to relieve some of the balsa a little bit to make sure one of these blind nuts could make it in, so that's all I'm working on right now. You might have seen me shaving a little bit of balsa there for a moment.
Allie, what are you doing over there?
Talking about lunch with Craig. Important
Craig,
stuff.
What was for lunch?
I had a pulled rib sandwich, actually. It was fantastic.
Spot in town, or did you make it yourself?
In town, Black Dog Barbecue.
Oh, yeah, there you go.
Other barbecue places are available before we get taken to court.
It's not bad.
Not bad. I'm not saying anything because I get myself in trouble.
They might be watching.
Exactly. If anyone from Black Dog is watching, love your place. Burnt ends recently.
Kev's over there now.
Kev?
Yeah, he came in as well.
He's our connoisseur, Kevin.
See if that helps. Not,
no Chick-fil-A for Kev today.
Not
Friday would have been. Yeah, right. Ran out of chicken.
Very good shape.
CA vanished.
There it is.
All right.
One motor installed.
Boom!
Pete's done. He's
just one.
Out.
Legend, yeah.
You know you need to reverse the shaft on that, right?
Oh no.
That's a funny joke.
When do you not? Do you not? Oh, you're using the collet.
Yeah, we're using the collet.
You didn't get me with it because I knew.
Yeah, because it came from me, so.
Right there, see how you go. Side-eyed, super glued.
We're fighting over it.
Yeah, right.
I don't know why, we've got a cupboard full of them behind. So.
Any other new questions, concerns?
We got David asking if we can show how the motor wires are routed. We'll probably show that once we get the ESC in, or Pete can show it now.
Yeah.
So there was actually a small hole just below the standard motor mount. You can see, there you go, they're routed right underneath there. So there was a small piece of wood that I just took out with an X-Acto blade, and I am routing them underneath through this hole. And then I just ran them right through there, and that is where our electronic speed controller is going to live there. Sorry if you weren't on the right feed to see all that detail, but you can check it out a little bit later.
Also, Pete, whilst you're there, quick one.
Yeah.
The camera.
Mm-hmm.
In the bottom of the fuselage here, you'll see there's the oval.
Yes.
Aperture. That's to be cut out if you go with the electric route.
All right.
That hole there is for the vent line. HAN116 is a hangar 9 fitting that is set up to the fuel overflow if you're using a gas option. We leave them uncut so you get the option of which one to open and which one to leave covered.
Obviously, there's a cooling vent for the electronics.
Yeah, I mean, this time of year, I very much doubt we're going to need the cooling vent, but based on the fact that Carl's going to be flying this throughout the summer, I would get an X-Acto blade
and just cut it there.
I mean, if we wanted to, if we had the time, I'd recommend sealing that edge. Heat iron, maybe some epoxy if you really want to get into it, but for the...
But it's Kyle's plane, so...
I don't know when this happened, but I like it.
Well, everyone doing your building work.
Yeah, right? It's a lot easier.
So Kyle, you want to remind people what channels we're live on?
Yes, so we are currently on Facebook on the Horizon Hobby. We're telling people that are already on it, but we're live on the Horizon Hobby Facebook page, the Hangar 9 Facebook page, which is what kind of the mobile cam is, and then we also have a YouTube stream on our horizonhobby.com channel. Those links, you won't be able to find it on YouTube, and you're not going to hear me talking right now anyway, but if you're on Facebook and wanting to tune in one of those other ones, the links are probably like the next post down or two from this. I did it this morning. I bumped them back up, so...
It's good info to have, though, for people who want to switch camera angles, if they want to go from the close-up cam to the bald spot cam or whatever. It's nice and easy to switch over. Control horns. Oh, I hate doing this bit.
I'll film you guys. Hinges are good.
What are you doing? You can't film. You just get working.
I've been drawing hinges.
Control horns. So, this bit is a little bit tedious. It's 3 bolts per control horn. There is a control horn on every flying surface. I do, just to be sure, I get an X-Acto, a sharp knife, and just run through. A drill would also work. They're plastic molded parts, so sometimes there's a little bit of molding flash, which will make life a little bit more difficult for the screw to go through. Just relieve that at this point. It makes this process a little bit less.
I have just blindly plugged the ESC into the motor, so that's something that we'll have to check real quick, make sure our motor direction's good, but that's just a quick...
So there's 3 wires that you can plug in, okay, and one of those wires plugged into the other plug will make it spin the right way and the wrong way.
Yep.
Gary Wright, what's the numbers on the chances of getting this right and wrong?
From my experience...
Right.
From my experience, there's a 0% chance of getting it right the first time, yeah.
I'm glad I'm not the only one.
Even though it's 1 out of 3, it's still 0%.
But I know of somebody who, when I one day was here cursing and blinding that I plugged it in the wrong way, ran the numbers and worked out the probability. Guess who that is, Pete?
3 guesses. Say Gaz.
The Gaz, if you don't mind.
There's only 9 options.
Is there?
Yeah. It's 3 to the second power. Or 3 to the third power.
This is live. It's falling on its face.
Kyle, we got a question on HH's Facebook.
Yes.
Michael missed the beginning of the live, but will this video be available after?
Yep. Yeah, so as soon as we end the video, essentially it'll take time to process since it'll be so long. So probably by this evening, 5 or 6 o'clock, I would imagine it'll be visible. The YouTube stream, same thing. It should be live.
Got those on right.
Honestly, I think a lot of people are probably going to watch this Hangar 9 cam because it's a lot of the detail shots. So this one will live, obviously, on the Hangar 9 Facebook, which is the camera I'm holding right now.
Yeah.
Big box. Washer.
And then I would, on that one, Pete, just put a little bit of blue Loctite on those.
Sure.
Just because that's where all the vibration seems to get transferred to. And having the undercrackers fall off midair is
less than ideal.
Well, yeah. That'd be hilarious. The car's flying and we're watching.
I'm doing that one second. And I put them on wrong. All the way through, this guy's trying to help me.
We got 73 on HH, yeah. 53 on Hangar 9. I know what
I'm doing. I got to the end.
42 on Facebook.
He must have been so happy that guy.
How dare you try and tell me what to do, sir?
We got Ethan bragging on Hangar 9, says he gets the motor direction correct every time.
Oh, no, impossible. Well, I mean, if you color code the actual shrink tubing, it's pretty easy to get it every time. But
Mark on Hangar 9 is asking what motor and ESC we're using.
Power 62, and then
52.
Yeah. And then what ESC are we using, Ellie? I'll just
Smart 60.
Not answer questions.
Smart Avian 60 amp controller.
And wrong.
So that's the new speed controller from Smart Technology Spectrum Smart. So it has a lot of telemetry data will come straight through to the radio. We're using I just thought about this actually. I was going to say we're using an IX20 because I'm setting it up, but what radio are we using, Carl?
Whatever we got.
Okay.
So like a DX8.
Hey Gary, we got a call out message for you, Gary. John on YouTube asks, so there's 27 different combinations to plug the motor into the ESC. How many correct possibilities is there?
That's your question. See, you laughed at me about that Facebook Live content.
My mind's on something else right now, and I have that dedicated thought.
You got a blank whiteboard behind you, Gary.
It's not blank. That's running wing loading numbers from On the Fly that's forthcoming, which is going to be a pretty interesting On the Fly.
I'm super excited about it. I've been going over through all the raw footage over the last couple of days. Should be really cool.
It should blow people away, huh?
Yeah.
It would be very high on entertainment value, that's for sure.
That wasn't a pun.
You still doing that wing?
I had to take a Twizzler break.
Twizzler break.
Allie, we got Mark asking, what or is there any differences between this Ultra Stick and the old Ultra Stick?
Yes, it was designed from the ground up. There was no shared CAD between the two. So in simple terms, yes, there is. It's a completely new airplane. But I'm going to be honest, Mark, it's an Ultra Stick. There's not that many ways of redesigning the wheel. It's a pretty straightforward aeroplane. I will say that when I did the 30cc Ultra Stick, one of my goals was to have a taller undercarriage on the 10cc than we had on the 30cc. Got feedback from people on the 30cc that were not able to fit bigger power plants than we suggested because of the undercarriage being quite low. So beefed it up on this one in terms of height. Also control surfaces. Increased the control surface size about 15% from the old Ultra Stick. So, yeah, little subtle changes, but no, I'm not going to lay claim to reinventing the wheel. It's a very much tried and tested design.
Reinventing the stick?
Yeah, hey.
Does the battery work? No.
Yes, sir. It is removable. It has a screw, so you can either have the battery fitted in there, not permanently, but with Velcro straps, or slide that tray in and out and leave the battery on the tray.
So we got JR asking on Hangar 9, since the landing gear takes the most abuse, how beefy is the landing gear mounting plate?
Get the camera in there.
Yeah. So, if you look down here, you can actually see, it's kind of hard to tell, but I'd say that that's more than a quarter inch of wood there that it's on. And yeah, there's three blind nuts there, very long screw, and then yeah, it sits right on there underneath there. So yeah, I'd say it has, I mean, my eyeball would say almost a half inch of wood that the gear is actually mounted to.
So yeah, plenty sturdy. Lots of meat there for the gear to hold on to. All right. I was going to start working on a tailwheel assembly, but I didn't see where the... Oh, never mind.
It's right here.
Yeah, got it.
And the silence kicks back in.
It's not silence, it's concentration.
We can have top hands on YouTube.
With the cat.
Thought Gary was doing some math over there.
Nice. It's proofreading manuals. One of the most exciting parts of a product developer's job.
Benko says he really loves this format. Are we going to consider doing more builds like this?
Heck no.
Oh, why'd you have to say that? Because now we have to. No, not unless they're my hanging iron builds. I've just, it's suddenly sunk in that I'm doing Carl's dirty work for him, so.
When did this happen?
Hats off to you for manipulating your fellow workforce and colleagues, but...
No, that's more of a Steve thing.
Yeah, right.
Ooh. Didn't we build an XCOM?
Oh, sorry, boss. Carl said that.
And don't we have to fix an X-Cub too?
We do have to fix the X-Cub, yeah.
Now what happened to the X-Cub? Steve.
Oh, Steve Petrada, if you're watching this.
So Kyle, you're just cutting through holes or drilling through?
Yeah, so basically you're drilling the holes. So I'll drill the holes, then you'll actually thread the screw through, unthread the screw, add some CA to kind of strengthen the wood, then you actually tighten it. So you're going to see me in and out with a lot of this stuff here.
Now those are self-tapping screws. You could be tempted just to drill straight into the wood. What will happen is that wood will split, and that will compromise the integrity of that servo mount, which when you consider they're driving your ailerons, it's really advisable. Again, it's one of those steps that people might see in the manual and go, oh, I can't be bothered, I'm just gonna drill the screw straight in. It's worth that extra 30 seconds per servo just to drill it and screw it into a pre-drilled pilot hole rather than split the wood.
Pete, what do you got going on over here?
I am starting on the tailwheel assembly.
Whistlers?
Yeah, absolutely.
To answer that question, I am all up for doing another build because I'm just looking at all that hangar 9 samples and development and demo planes we have to build, so yeah. Let me retrack. If I came across negative about doing this collaborative build process, I'm all for it.
Yep. Maybe a certain camo plane we have.
Yeah, we have some camo planes.
A camo plane?
Camo plane.
What camo?
Must be a warbird.
No.
It's not a warbird?
I think it's a crossbreed plane.
Easy.
Cup stain.
Quiet after that one. Shut it down. Damn it.
Okay.
What's happening, P?
Oh, just learning how to put a tailwheel together on your little aircraft here. That part needs some. There's some hardware for it. Alright.
Armory Saturday night, Craig.
What are we doing?
Armory.
Oh, yeah.
Armory.
Indoor flying.
Yeah.
Come on. That guy. We need some Ultric pilots. 42. We want to do an on the fly. I'll take them. I'll take them there for you. They'll be charged, ready.
Nice.
Gary, if you're available.
Saturday night.
Where else would you be on a Saturday night in Champagne?
Sitting on my...
Yes, I got it.
Fat rear end in front of the TV.
Well, it's Armory Saturday night, 5 till 7. Okay.
Al, we got Mark asking if this version has the option for flaps.
Yes, it comes with ailerons and flaps out of the box. We actually have chosen the optional route, which is the solid ailerons.
You mean the easy route?
I thought you were going to correct me on the pronunciation of route then.
So you have to buy full span ailerons separately?
Correct.
Okay.
Unless you want to, again, you can if you want to mix ailerons and flaps together out of the box. These full-span aileron is for those that want to have just two servos in the wing.
Make it a little lighter?
Lighter and quicker to build. The purposes of this video is what it's all about.
Realistically, less channels on a radio too, so if you're really trying to build maybe a 5-channel plane.
Good thinking, Carl. You could even, if you wanted to, thinking out loud, you could retrofit either way.
Do you happen to know that part number off the top of your head?
Do you?
Nope.
Oh, then. I don't know the part number of the projects I'm working on now, yet alone an optional part of a part that I developed 3 years ago.
So Misko asked if these lives will be available after. Once the live's done, of course.
Yep.
Yeah, I'm guessing that's probably the people who are jumping in late and want to see the, the lead-in. So, yeah, basically the way Facebook works is the live will end and then it'll kind of disappear for a while. And that's kind of Facebook, almost like when you upload a video, it has to process. But since this is going to be probably at least 2 hours long, it's going to take a little while for it to actually kick on as a video. So don't freak out when this is over and you try to go back and it's just missing. Give it some time.
Paul is probably our number one commenter on YouTube.
Thank you, Paul.
Oh, was that it?
Yeah.
who's our lowest commenter?
Lowest commenter. Probably the people that haven't commented.
There you go.
Way to leave us hanging, Max.
Yeah, no problem. There. That's what I'm here for.
Hey, we take the radio off the other ultra stick up there and throw that in.
Which way did I say?
What?
Oh, I'm kind of jealous that I have to build the airplane.
So you can almost fly home. Yeah.
That's the idea.
Is there comments
so
for not making it to...
Again, I learned early on with one of my first development planes. I didn't think that people have limited channel radios, and I set the ailerons up, or flaps up in particular, that you had to use an electronic means of reversing them. So on this airplane, it's got it, you can do it both sides.
Yeah, so we kind of just talked and didn't actually explain what we're talking about. There's holes for the control horn to where you can put the servo either direction on both sides. And that's, like Ali said, so that you could actually have them Y-harness to where essentially they're kind of operating together, but they're doing the opposite direction. I'm getting deep here. Or you have separate channels where it operates independently, more of a traditional sense.
It's the way of the insider series.
Yeah.
So we got Tony asking if we're going to use a Spectrum 637T receiver.
I don't even know what that is.
What's that?
637T, yes.
Yeah.
It's just the way you said it there.
Oh, yeah, sorry. I'm a surface guy over here.
We have two receivers out here, one of them...
Yeah, we have a choice of
what is that?
7350 or the new 637. I like the 9350. I like the 9350 because it's a receiver that I've used a lot, and it has everything I need in it. But the new 637 has just come out, or it's just coming out, sorry. And whilst that has AS3X in it, it also has forward programming, so I can set it up from my radio. I don't need a separate device. And the ability to set safe up. So I think it's, Craig, am I right? Is it our first receiver that we can program safe?
Yes. Yeah.
So up until now, our safe system has been baked in to our bind and fly airplanes.
Well, trainers mostly, if we want to make the distinction between safe and safe select.
Okay.
So, but yeah, 637T definitely first one with user programmable and selectable safe via forward programming, which is unbelievable.
We gotta make sure that the somebody can part of the build process.
Somebody can buy a Hangar 9 airplane now, and if they feel happier having that safe
as a fallback,
security device.
Now, what do you think? You want a foam tailwheel or a rubber tailwheel?
So pros and advantages, right? Rubber is louder, correct?
Yeah, always the foam one, sorry, foam. I was going to say, probably go with the foam one because it's already on there.
Okay, good job.
That was an easy decision.
Yeah, that's almost like Ali bringing up the servo location, already knowing the answer.
I didn't. How did I know the answer? I said put him in the back, and then Gary Wright spoke to you the other day, and I saw the gears turning inside your head. I was like, I wonder, did he go with my advice or Gary's? It's all right, don't worry.
We could do one of each, but what's the difference?
Right? I don't take it personally.
Put the rudder servo in the back, elevator up front.
Nearly done with the control horns.
We have three streams.
Ethan said he's got five more minutes and then he's going to go home, charge up some batteries, and go flying.
Oh, not jealous, Ethan. We've probably got about
Wait a minute, you didn't start charging batteries when you opened the box for the airplane?
No. For us, our batteries are charged.
Rule number one.
Done. No, they're already. I brought them in. I was flight testing yesterday and was prepared enough to get the batteries ready. What are you doing, Pete?
Looking for something to do. We got your tail all taken care of. The rudder's got to go on.
Twizzle's not going to eat himself.
Yeah, all right.
It's all our stick themed.
I think, Pete, snaps. You should get the camera.
Craig, you want a beef stick?
Oh, no, thank you.
I was thinking that.
No, what variety is that?
We got several.
We got, this is spicy taco. We got mild.
What are we talking about? Twizzlers?
Original.
Those are not Twizzlers.
Spicy taco Twizzlers?
Buffalo style.
How great would that be? You should give them a call.
Servo hatch.
Buffalo? Is it buffalo?
Buffalo style.
Are we still talking about Twizzlers?
No, beef sticks.
Meat sticks.
If Twizzlers are watching, we just gave them a whole bunch of good ideas.
JR's wondering what's the plan for the flap servos? Are we going to leave the covers on the wing?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll just screw the covers on. So if at a later stage Carl decides he wants to use a four servo wing and do crow and so forth, then he can do.
How does one unglue those ailerons? Samurai.
Samurai sword. Gotcha. Always. Yeah, it's not the nicest of jobs in the world, but you can cut Ciano hinges or CA hinges.
Because we have something where you cut it on the model, right? What am I thinking of?
Cut it on the model?
Yeah, where we have a full span thing and you choppy choppy.
Oh, Tiger. You had me at choppy choppy.
Technical.
Yeah, Tiger 30. Tiger 30 comes with a one-piece aileron. That if you so desire and want to use flaps, you just slice the choppy choppy bit, and away you go.
Allie Bryan wants to know if you'll go out to LA and help him make his 30cc Ultra Stick.
No problem. I'm in LA every October at an event called Best in the West. So if he can wait till October, I'm there.
Or pay for your ticket there in your time off.
I'm in LA in April at a wedding. So yeah, if we can coordinate it.
There you go, Brian.
Where's the reception? Just bring it along.
Yeah.
Put a dress on.
It's at a country club, so yeah. 18th Green. We just go and get a couple of flights. It'll be good. What could go wrong?
Speaking of what could go wrong, we're gonna fly this later, right? How's the weather?
It's beautiful outside. It's really nice.
Beautiful, yeah. Pete.
Yes, sir.
I think. No, I don't want. It's a bad idea.
Oh,
it's always a bad idea. Right.
Now you're gonna have people asking, "What was your bad idea, Alan? What were you gonna
all
do?"
Of them.
Well, Brian wants you to come out this weekend, Alan.
Oh, Brian, come on, give me a little bit more time. This is till Friday.
Tony said there will be no time at the wedding.
Ah, Christy. I forgot. Don't tell Joe, Tony, please.
I mean, what are we talking? All expenses paid.
Right.
This is up to Brian. He needs to hop on here and coordinate it.
No, I'm busy this weekend. Armory Saturday. We're indoor flying. All right. Petey. That's what I want you to do. Did you mix the cocktail, right?
Yeah, I was going to say 5 minutes.
Drying four.
Yep.
Don't share my mixing cup collection.
Hashtag Freddy's. Thank you very much.
We do sell mixing cups, though.
We do, don't we? He refuses to use them.
No.
Yeah.
The nice clear ones?
Yeah. Really? Look at him.
Uh-oh. We spurred him on.
Comfrey branded. All right.
HH mixing cup.
I swore we weren't going to do.
So, Allie, are you putting a particular amount of epoxy in there?
Well, you've got to be careful using the right amount, because if you use more of the particular resin as opposed to hardener, it may not set properly. So, right. If you can get it 50-50, it's good.
Perfect.
I'm leaving.
Flying out to Vegas.
Right? Why?
Oh! Damn.
Yeah, maybe you and Brian can meet up in Vegas and fly the plane. Oh,
good idea. Halfway ground.
There you go.
Can I bring my dad?
Fine with me.
Oh my god. So anyway.
Bring chips for the salsa.
Oh. Love a bit of salsa.
I ate salsa last night. It's good.
Kyle filleting a servo door.
Trying my best. The key is to fillet the door and not your fingers, right? Or glue your hand to it.
If possible.
Right, so you're an hour in. How long to go yet?
Another hour. We'll be done, I think. Ask the boss. This is his gig.
Coy Harvey's asking if the Toledo special is still available.
No, I'm afraid not. That was some time ago. That one went away.
Yeah, I didn't even know about that one.
Yeah, Coy, my dad's favorite. He loves that Toledo special. He's still got his. That's how I drilled all the other two holes first time. As soon as your eyeball was gone, yeah. Me.
Hate that.
So, interesting, boring facts for those watching. Where we're working today is the Hangar 9 development condo or development workshop here at Horizon Hobby. So, all of the Hangar 9 designs. For the last, what, we've been here for a year? Just over a year, right?
Yep.
Yeah, we've been in this location for approximately a year now, and this is where all of the development work for Hangar 9 work.
Magic happens.
Yeah, right. So there's a team of two of us on Hangar 9, myself and Gary Wright, work on around about four projects a year apiece. Well, yeah, between us now, five projects. So. Yeah, as I said earlier, we have about a two-year development process in a Hangar 9 aeroplane from the moment of inception to when we actually have it released on the market. There are a couple that have actually taken longer than 2 years. There's one that's actually a lot shorter than 2 years. It's probably just under the 12-month mark at the moment, but that's an exceptional circumstance. Normally, it's around about 2 years. So. Given any other normal Friday, this area will be taken up with a future development aeroplane. Unless, of course, we're going to an event and we need a specific aeroplane assembled and ready to display at that event. Gary and I will be working on samples. I know Gary test flew a new sample Hangar 9 aeroplane yesterday that he's been working on for a while. All being well, you should see that. It's 2020 release, right?
August of 2020, yeah.
There you go. So,
yeah, that's a real fast one.
Yep, and that is the second sample. He flew the first sample electric power, and then this second sample test flew yesterday with gas power. So, yeah, all being well with the flight testing, you should see that August. That's one I'm particularly excited about. He's managed to take an aeroplane that I've never really been a fan of personally and fly so well that I look forward to owning one. Myself, I'm working on three different Hangar 9 aeroplanes right now, two of which you should see in 2020, and then there's two more after that, and the other spare, which is in 2021. So.
Kyle, Paul wants to know if Searchy's still around.
I don't know, I haven't seen him in a while.
Hopefully not.
We killed him.
What am I missing?
That stupid helmet thing, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was.
Oh, man, I was involved in that.
Yes, you were.
Do you remember how stressed I got?
Yes.
No, don't say like that.
Hey, Allie?
Yes?
Before you glue that elevator on, are you going to flip it over the correct way so the controller's on top?
Good spot, guys. Oh, look at that. Well spotted. Rookie mistake. That's what you get when you're rushing. I just put the control horn on upside down.
It's all right, Kyle messed up too. So I should have taken one of the other doors, correct? Think about it.
Yeah. You can raise it, yeah, it'd be easiest to, better to do it that way. Well, you can center it on that.
Okay.
There's enough travel on that, it's okay. Fine. It won't be perfectly symmetrical, but we'll get away with it.
Or should I just cut another door?
I wouldn't, because then you're going to have the slot.
It's venting.
It's not like you just showed it to everyone and Pete zoomed in on the...
That's fine.
This is all part of the building process. Even the professionals get it wrong.
Unscripted. It is live.
Uh-huh, very much so.
Still, my favorite part was when Kyle glued the servo door to his finger. That was pretty great.
We've all done it.
Yeah.
Brian wants to know if we're ever releasing a timber fox.
Probably not at this stage.
That definitely was a one-off, you know. Well, we are going to bring out another video on the timber fox to kind of elaborate, because there was a lot of confusion. There was a lot of people thought that that was something that we were actually releasing, where that was just one of your projects. It was something to kind of inspire people for the build season. And what else now?
No, I'll just drop this thing.
Okay. Yeah, as much as we'd like to, it gets very difficult to have multiple SKUs, as we call them, for a particular airplane. So if we were to bring the Timber Fox out, it presents a logistical problem internally, because we'd have to stock all of the spares again for that particular color scheme. I also think, and I didn't check because it was never a commercial entity, but I think there may be some licensing agreements with the owner of that color scheme in that airplane. So yeah, we'll probably just stick to it as what it was, which was me wanting to customize a Hangar 9 airplane. Show what you can do with a Hangar 9 airplane, that you're not just stuck to the stock color scheme. With that in mind, I'm working on two projects at the moment, which are current Hangar 9 airplanes that are going to come out with different color schemes, just to show how different they can look. Some of you more eagle-eyed may have spotted one of those Hangar 9 airplanes in the workshop right now.
I was on the other side of the room there for a minute, and I was like, oh, and I pointed the camera back down. So if you caught it, good on you. If you didn't, oh well.
But yeah, stay tuned. We should get those videos out of different color schemed Hangar 9 or personalized Hangar 9 airplanes before the spring.
So, Ali, can I ask you a question?
No.
No?
What you ask?
So, okay, I'm relatively new to the bolster hobby anyway.
Okay.
And I'm going to get a lot of flack for saying this, but this plane's ugly. I don't like it. It's a flying box.
You never insult somebody's airplane. It's not my baby.
I'm not a huge fan of this airplane. Why?
Beautifully practical.
Okay, that makes sense. I know that there's a lot of people who are huge fans of this airplane. Oh, and I guess my big question is, why? Why would you like this silly square airplane so
practicality,
much?
Practicality, simplicity, versatility, durability, all the abilities. It's like, it does what it's meant to do. It's, you know, form versus function is a discussion me and my work colleague over there have on a daily basis. Mm-hmm. And there is that happy blend. You know, and me putting wheel pants on this was what made it just enough form that it was excusable. But yeah, an ultra stick without wheel pants, no.
And obviously you are not the original creator of the stick. No. So it has a lot of heritage then too, which
decades.
I don't even know anything about.
I don't know much about the actual. I know from when I was a kid, there was a plane called Das Ultra Stick, mm-hmm. which is probably my first memories of a stick. No, sorry, Das Ugly Stick. And even in the name, it used to be known, still is known, the original forefather was Ugly Stick. That was the name, yeah. We decided to put Ultra in front of it so nobody would notice it was ugly. But yeah, it's been around for decades and decades. Gaz, you probably know more about the original sticks than I do.
The original Ugly Stick was designed by Phil Kraft. He used it to test radio systems, if you remember Kraft radios. I'm very old, so I remember that stuff. And the Ugly Stick flies so well that it's been reincarnated in a million different versions.
Okay. Yeah, and it's one of those planes, Pete, that is sought after. It's people like it, they like the durability and simplicity.
You want to just trade the cameras? We'll have mine down on the ground for a little bit.
Yeah.
Cool.
To use a term beta or basher, as the car guys use, you know, it's probably applicable to this airplane.
Pete, we got Eric calling you out and says, if you think it's ugly, then you've obviously never flown one.
He is correct. Yeah.
This and is coming from the guy that flies quads, by the way.
this is true.
Form versus function, Pete.
Oh, yeah, all quads are ugly. There is not a single attractive quad that I know of.
No, we made that one with Mirko, with the yellow one that had that. Oh, it was all right.
Oh, the Zayrock?
She lost me at names. But I remember it was yellow, I was like, oh, cool, it's a half-decent looking quad.
Well, do you want to put that camera in the tripod and we'll walk around with this
one? Sure. Yeah, we're swapping cameras real quick, guys, so we can keep batteries charged, so bear with us through the
blocking. Yeah, these are the technical difficulties going on.
Notice who's doing all the building now.
Yeah. Cool. I'll
switch all this out. You're doing the assembling.
Building. Oh, boy. Gary Wright said it's building. Sandpaper and, what was the other one, covering iron?
Yep.
If it needs sandpaper and a covering iron,
trade me. I'll get that one set.
Alright, so now our build cam is now the Horizon Facebook page.
And that's just to keep phone batteries alive here. So we'll swap them back in a little bit. But this might be cool because it'll give everyone a nice little other look that might only be watching on HH. If I can get this thing straight level. There we go.
Hopefully another thing this shows for anyone who's going to watch the entirety or just tune in at the end is it breaks down the misconception that you need to have hundreds and hundreds of hours to build a Balsa Raft.
Yeah.
It's another reason, I think, Pete, to go back to your question of why the Ultra Stick. Why do people like the Ultra Stick?
Yeah.
It's simple. It's simple to fly. It's simple to put together. It's simple to maintain. It's simple to transport. And, you know, where we're at right now, if this had a cowling on it and a canopy and a cockpit...
Oh, it'd be...
It all adds to the build time. And whilst there is definitely room for that, you know, it's all about the hobby, there are a lot of people that just want to have something that they get in the air as quick as possible. Yeah. And this thing, we're going to do it today. There's just pretty much, you know, it's obvious now. It may take another hour or so, but we are going to get this thing flyable today. So a weekend's worth of work, and you can have a Balsa 10cc airplane up and running.
Hold on to this for just a moment.
Steve is back. He had to leave, but he's back now, just so you guys know.
Okay.
Kyle, we're now getting your bald spot in the YouTube Live.
Bald spot?
No. Lick me.
Lick me. Just needed two hands for that operation for just a moment.
So, Ali, I'm kind of eyeballing the length of these servo wires, and it looks like they're going to just barely make it out of that the actual hole there.
Extension lead.
Yep. So, always. What are you thinking for this to go to the receiver? 6-inch, 9-inch? I grabbed a bunch of 9-inch, but...
6 is enough.
Okay.
Because don't forget, you want to have a extension lead that allows you to plug and unplug the wing.
Right.
So if you had that direct to the receiver, the receiver is going to be hard mounted here. You'd have to fiddle around. So what I recommend is just having a 2 or 3 inch protrusion there, and then probably a 3-inch, 6-inch extension lead here.
Perfect.
So that way when your wing goes on, you can get it all together.
Perfect.
I mean, I've seen some people make up these single plug, which are really cool. Saw it, fun enough, today on a RC group thread, somebody had made it up and it was brilliant. He just plugged it in. And that was on the Ultra Stick thread, fun enough.
Drew, the Timber Fox, if you want to know what the Timber Fox is, go to horizonhobby.com's YouTube page and check out On the Fly. We had a pretty cool plane that we had put together for a project, and we were able to share it on horizonhobby.com, on the YouTube channel and on the Facebook page. You should go check that out. I already got that partially done for you. Looking for servo extensions, Kyle?
We only have 800 of them.
So you know that those are supposed to go on the...
What?
Inside of the wing.
Yeah, I got it.
Okay.
No, that was me eyeballing to see the wire length to see, like I was talking to Allie about, what we're going to need.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Good job.
Yeah, so basically, if you've never seen this before, you'll tape essentially the strings that are hanging out. You'll use that to pull your extension and servo lead through.
Yeah, get a closer shot of what you're doing over here.
I love how Gary's just waiting for us.
Hey!
Yes.
I think you should make me a cup of coffee now. Speak to Gary Wright. We have a wealth of information, a mine of information over there. Long-term aero modeler, very experienced heli pilot, RC pilot, has run his own kit company within the RC industry. Mm-hmm. Dude, he's got stuff that's far more interesting than watching me trying to badly put in a hinge.
Yeah, but he's boring to talk to.
I don't know. I talk to you every day. Aww.
Hello, Gary. Do you have any regarding the Ultra Stick and the stick overall? Have any interesting anecdotes for us or anything that, do you have any experience with this type of model?
I actually have one of those at home that I put together about a year and a half ago.
Okay. Oh, this exact plane.
That exact plane, yeah.
Have you ever had a stick from different manufacturers?
A few dozen of them.
Oh, just a couple dozen?
How long have you been flying RC for, Gaz?
Just over 40 years.
Is that all?
Yeah. July will be 41.
So I assume we'll publisher.
We're all big fans of Mr. Wright around here, but one thing that we do give him flack for is that that we thought when flight was first invented that it was Orville, Wilbur, and Gary, because he's a Wright as well. So I don't think he's been in the hobby quite that long, but we like to mess with him every once in a while.
And you were actually involved in the hobby in a manufacturing point of view, though.
Yeah, I made some kits, some that have been in it for a couple decades. You may remember the E3D series, true electric 3D capable airplanes, and those were some of my kits.
And when was this? What sort of era?
2000 through maybe 2008, I believe. Really enjoyed making the kits, but demand dwindled to a point
where it wasn't worth doing. And by kits, just to clarify, because there'll be some people that have never had an experience with building a Borsa kit, you're talking about literally flat pack, small narrow box, everything had to be glued together, then covered.
Yeah, an airplane this size came in a box that was 4 inches square and 36 inches long. Yeah.
And what would be the average build time of something like that, Gaz? Average, not your build time, because I know you are incredibly fast when it comes to assembling an airplane, or building an airplane.
I really have no idea. It takes me about 6 hours to get one covered and ready to fly from an absolute kit.
Over here finishing my job, getting the rotor and tail wheel installed. I left the hardware over here for you.
David's asking if we're using a 4 or 5S battery. Using a 6S.
I know the completion guide does call for a 5S, but I think you want a little bit extra power right now.
I think so. We'll give it a try.
They're using a 6 on here on this prop because they know that the smart speed controls are, shall we say, somewhat underrated, and they have a lot of excess headroom that they will be using.
So you saw that, what I was doing with the Sino then?
Yeah, and I've seen you do that before. You usually throw a little bit of very thin CA, right, in there, and that just shores up the actual hole because the fibers of the balsa can sometimes not be that strong.
Yeah, when we're tapping into balsa like that, if I just went in with the screw, it would tighten up, but over time it would open up and the screw would fall out. So yeah, the Sino in there makes that mounting point a lot stiffer, harder, more durable.
Hey,
Alan.
Screws, freeze.
We have lots of guests when you build in the open. There's one of our other videographers, Alan Welch. If you've ever had a product video that you were really excited about that you thought was really cool, it's probably this guy.
Cool. Oh, you're talking about me.
Oh yeah.
Why is the screen all blue?
I don't know. That's your equipment.
The actual output on the live is just fine.
Okay. All right. Just checking.
You showed up just in time to catch that though.
Important bit, Pete.
Yeah.
How's it going?
The pull test.
Oh yeah.
Once you've glued a hinge in, don't assume that it's fully set. Give it time for the glues to hard. Help yourself, man.
That totally makes sense. That's something that
you don't want your first time.
I wouldn't have even thought of that.
I've even forgotten in some cases, or I've seen as well, people haven't glued it in. Because the Sino hinges are so tight, you slot in, you go, oh, okay, and you move on to something else. First flight, off comes the control surface. So that pull test is super important.
Yeah.
Servos. Carl, you want servos inside, didn't you?
Yes.
Have fun.
Thank you, Al. We never finished the Gary Wright story.
Yeah.
So one of these is long.
Franz asked if we're actually building a plane on the table. I sure hope we're actually building.
We are, yeah. Assembling an airplane, building a plane, yeah. We are putting an ultra stick together on the table.
It's not. It's on the table, not on the fly.
Hey. Shane, this part we love.
All the puns.
I like that these doors were all pre-drilled, all the screw holes.
Yeah.
So I'm still tapping it. I'm going to add some CA for strength.
Okay.
Also, Allie, full transparency, when I was pulling off the little top hatch here, we might need to see that just a little bit.
Okay.
Gotta call myself out on the live for breaking stuff.
It's all right. Better you tell me now.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, I bet I know why that failed mid-flight.
Are you at a point now where if I ask if I can help, there's nothing for me to do? I was kind of waiting on that point.
You can finish off these Twinkies, Gary.
No.
He's more of a savory person than a sweet one.
I heard he's pretty unsavory.
Oh.
Getting here close. Routing some pusher rods here, right?
So you still design and build your own airplanes, right, guys?
I sure do.
As well as hangar 9. What have you been working on recently?
I really can't say, because what if they become Hangar 9 airplanes at some point?
Good point. Okay.
Yeah.
And as well as Hangar 9, you work quite a lot on the E-Flight team. I know that...
Correct. I have more foam projects going than wood projects.
Okay. I know you are the brains behind recent releases such as the Twin Otter.
Well, several projects like that one I took over in the middle, so someone had started them.
Just take credit. Right, come on, I forgot who we're talking to.
Yeah.
He's too modest.
Yeah, the Twin Otter, the Turbo Timber, the Timber X.
When is your next release due out, guys?
Oh. 2 weeks from now.
I won't ask what it is.
And then another one a week after that.
Wow.
What color is it, Gary?
And another one in April, and another one in June.
So Gary is one of six PDs on the phone team?
Six, yeah.
That's a good guess. So yeah, to say our phone team is pretty active would be an understatement. I know 2020 and 2021 are going to be busy years. 2019 was a busy year. Do you remember how many releases we had in 2019?
It was more than one a month, which is a lot.
It is a lot. Like I said, when you consider there are usually a year or 2 years in between each project. So, yeah. Just imagine all the cool stuff we released last year. Just imagine all the cool stuff we're releasing in 2 years from now that I see Gary and Dave and Matt and Kevin and Russell working on. So, for those that want to know, two doors down is the foam development room. If you bribe Petey enough, he might take you for a tour of
there.
Oh boy! Top secret.
No.
Gary Wright said it was okay.
I need a lot of money in donations for that to happen. Don't start.
Donations or severance?
Yeah.
Severance is more like it. Yeah.
What about that back? Those two doors there, Pete. What about those?
Whoa! That's the Hangar 9 development room. You don't go there.
Yeah.
Come on, we only have there a few releases every year.
The amount of secrets behind that, those brown double doors, yeah. If you guys only knew.
So Drew's asking if we're ever going to release a Draco.
In Hangar 9?
I think he's just asking in general.
I don't know. It's not on Hangar 9 radar at the moment, but when I think about how we develop stuff and how quickly we move, it's not impossible.
Gotta have more questions. We went a while where
they were
given Gary's biography.
Yeah. Paul is probably spamming us on YouTube right now. He's definitely our top commenter. He's Kyle's number one fan.
No way.
Hi, Paul.
Yep, he is Kyle's fan.
I almost asked Gary if the original Ultra Stick was black and white, but I figured that was...
Oh. Easy with the age stuff. He's only a little bit older than me. Give me a complex.
Kyle has a Luke Burnett. Is that what's going on over there?
I don't know.
Oh, I'm on the same page then.
Well done, Kyle.
I caught up.
Five.
Fellow enthusiasts.
Yes.
Got a bit of fellow enthusiast here.
Is that 564th in that?
That's cool. A big bomb, guys.
Yeah, probably. It came from Gary, so it's probably the correct size. Because I did not have the correct size.
No? Should have asked.
There we got a good question. What is each guy's favorite airplane to fly?
Ooh, that's good.
I'll start with Kyle.
Oh, why would you start with me? I've only flown like eight.
Because Allie's flown a bunch of planes, so he's got to think. Pete, you cannot say a quad.
Airplane. Favorite airplane to fly?
Yeah.
And it can't be Unreal Flight.
That's an interesting question.
Man, you're having a hard time answering.
No, well, the problem is, what plane I want to say, I don't want to say. So, honestly, probably my favorite flying plane was the P-39. I hate it. Visually, I just hate it, to be honest. For me, a warbird, I feel like it should just be tail dragger. It should have that menacing, like, silver, you know, real fighter look. I know the P-39 was a fighter, but... The P-39, when I went to fly it, I'm like, all right, let's quickly do this video and get out of here. And I flew it, I'm like, oh man, this thing's great. 4S, plenty of power, steerable, nose wheel, tricycle landing gear, fast, strong, as we proved during our Halloween shoot. If you didn't watch that, if you're on YouTube, look up Haunted Flying Field and then put like Eli or Horizon. The P-39 literally sliced a Night Radian wing right in half, both of which have been fixed.
Yep.
But it's like a tank. It's literally like a tank.
So that is your favorite flying airplane, even though it's your least favorite aesthetically.
Yes.
Okay.
Yep.
Allie, what do you think? It's your favorite? And this is going to be a hard one for you because you either...
It's not hard. It's just physics. I get asked this question a bit, and it's impossible because there's so many different categories. It's the thing about the RC flying hobby, pretty much anything RC, it's almost infinite in terms of what you can do, how you can do it. You can fly slow, you can fly fast, you can fly big, you can fly small. And being in the position I'm in, I try and abuse that position as much as I can and fly as much as different stuff as I can. So.
And what he's not telling you guys is that I actually know what his favorite airplane is.
You do?
Right now. Yep.
Right now.
Yep. It's the eFlight P-51 1.5 meter.
That was yesterday. Okay. Yeah, this time yesterday, I would say the 1.5 meter Mustang was the best plane.
And that's 1.5 meter.
Yeah, 1.5 meter.
okay,
that's the big one.
Okay.
Yeah, we.
It was 1.5 meter though.
It's 1.5 meter.
Okay.
We
from the box is 1.5 meter.
If you guys don't know, we have a show called On the Fly where we try to make new and interesting. topics and aircraft to fly, so look for that coming very soon. We have a very cool 1.5 meter P-51.
1.5 meter.
But yeah, back to the original question. You'd have to categorize it. You'd have to say work airplane, personal airplane.
What's your favorite personal plane at this moment?
Probably my big F-86 Sabre. German company called Tomahawk. It's a very large, third scale, turbine-powered jet. And the reason why it's my favorite is a mixture, a blend of different things. The way it flies, of course, the way it looks helps. But it's super reliable. It provides that super scale flying experience, but without what can sometimes be the headache and rigmarole of being troublesome and difficult to operate. That thing to me is I can take it out, I can fly it 180 mile an hour, I can fly it 30 mile an hour. I can, you know, fly it like a sport jet, aerobatics and so forth, or fly it like a scale plane. So, yeah.
So, with that said, so if you guys want to check out the F-86 in question, that was at Joe Nall 2019. Woohoo! That one went flying.
That's our born.
So, if you look up Allie McKinsey, F-86 Sabre. You'll be able to see his very cool camouflage. It's like almost, what would you call that? The camo scheme on your F-86.
Dreamt up,
fictitious. Yeah, it is fictitious.
What if color scheme?
Yeah. But Drew actually modified his question because you weren't sure. What is your favorite foamy to fly right now?
Foamy to fly right now. I can't say because it's not been released.
Yeah, I know which one it is. I haven't released it yet.
It's an airplane that our foam development team, Mandarin in particular, Mr. Foam as he's known in the office, rightly so, is developing for release this year. And yeah, it's blew me away how well it flew, how fast it flew. Yeah, that's going to be cool.
So he answered your question, but he actually didn't answer your question at all.
No, let's go. Let's get into foam airplanes that I enjoy. There's another one I flew yesterday.
Right. Yeah, we both thought of that. There's one other plane that you guys haven't seen yet that we've been flying and having a blast with.
E-Flight F-16. Yep. 70mm F-16. For bang for buck, for, as you said, smiles per hour. I love that phrase. Yeah, that airplane for me is the one. You know, I think about how much fun I've had versus the return on investment, like in terms of cost, in terms of practicality and so forth. I love that airplane, so yeah.
Pete, what about you?
So mine's really easy. It was a plane that I put over 100 flights on. I actually marked them on the inside of the fuselage, but it was my FMS BAE Hawk. I ran it without a gyro, just had a regular receiver in it, and absolutely adored it. Unfortunately, I need to get another one.
I like the way you said that.
I'm thinking about on its 115th flight. Unfortunately, I didn't have the radio that it was bounded to a new radio. Was not a diligent pilot in my pre-flight checks,
rookie
and now I need to get another FMS BAE Hawk.
There he is.
My ailerons are
the man, the myth, the legend, Cameron Wilson. Everyone.
So going off of Pete's kind of sadness there, Drew asked another question.
I know where this is going.
What's your, most favorite crash, but most memorable crash?
Ooh. Yeah, he wants to know our saddest crash.
There you go.
Oh, mine's easy. Going first.
Mine's easy.
Mine is easy.
I don't crash.
There you go. Done.
Kyle, I've been on a lot of shoots with you lately.
Oh, Max. Throwing his teeth.
We're not talking about you crashing into me.
No.
Okay. Favorite crash. See, mine have never. I know this sounds bad. Like, it doesn't sound bad. I've never, like, destroyed a plane in a crash. I've always been able to pick it back up. Maybe I ripped the gear off. Hand launched it. Crap. I don't know. Hold on. A lot of helis. I could talk about a lot of heli crashes. Favorite crash. Did I destroy anything, Max, that you can think of?
Not destroy, but I think it's been glued back together and flown again.
That's all of them.
Well, yeah.
I can think of, we were doing a kind of an extreme wind flight out at Eli, and we had the mall.
That's the beans.
And we were, see how I do that? Kyle was right above the runway, and it was real gusty, and we had full flaps, and we basically had it hovering, and then Mother Nature was like, watch this, and shut down
the headway. Oh, my beer.
So it just went.
Yep.
And broke the prop, broke the landing gear.
Yeah.
But at that point, we still had the plane.
If I'm not mistaken, you flew it after the crash, didn't you?
Yeah. It was louder.
Yeah.
Sorry. I got a good one. Carbon Cup 1.3. I was at a park. It's a good, really good park flyer. And I was getting overconfident and decided I was going to land on the sidewalk that had several large trees next to it. And right as I was coming in, nice, tight, it just clipped the tree and spun around and landed. And I just grabbed it. Oh, it's fine. Flew again. So that was probably my favorite crash because it was like, it almost looked planned because it was so elegant and graceful. And then I just...
Can you show us how it hit the tree again?
Graceful.
That's also how I hand launch now.
Yeah.
Pete, we'll go to you.
That was my FMS Hawk.
Okay. Oh, man,
you can't use the same story.
This one airplane's getting serious miles.
Yep. Allie, what do you think? What's your saddest crash?
Saddest crash or favorite crash?
Either or.
What was the question, Matt?
Oh, saddest crash.
It was saddest, yeah.
I thought I was going to get away with saddest.
They're all sad. I was hoping it was favorite, because I was going to say I don't have a favorite crash. Because I hate crashing.
Yep. You going to tell them it's gone? No.
What's that? What's gone?
It?
No!
No. All this insider stuff that everybody watching is like, wow, tell them what was that?
No, Pete's talking about me crashing the Timber Fox. That was sad, definitely. But no, my saddest crash was one that is probably my most documented crash.
I know that one right away. It's sad. The Hawker Hunter, right?
Thanks for that. it's sad because it was all my fault. It was so avoidable. I was just getting greedy flying and having such a fun time. I forgot to charge packs. And yeah, it was a pretty hefty, it was a turbine aeroplane, so the price tag associated with it was pretty high. But what a lot of people don't realize is the color scheme applied to the aeroplane was really particularly special.
Oh, so like a urban graffiti almost, right?
It was a scale color scheme, and it was only special because, well, super special because the person who applied it had spent a lot of work, and he was a dear friend of mine. He never got to see the aeroplane fly, which is a real bummer. And it was avoidable. Like, most crashes are. Mm-hmm. I felt very, very annoyed afterwards to make such a rookie mistake.
So not that Ali wants that video on YouTube to have any higher of a view count, but if you type in four words, four words.
Do it.
Ali Machinchi, Hawker Hunter. That is the first video that will pop up if you want to check that out. Yeah, unfortunately, Ali's saddest crash was documented, so you can check that out. Not that he really wants you to, I don't think.
Not at all. But yeah.
Now off the sad topic, what's your favorite crash?
Favorite crash is ones that I don't have or get away with. Yesterday I nearly had a favorite crash. When the wings fell off an aeroplane and I saved it.
He's not kidding, folks. He is not kidding. He lost
both wings.
Yeah.
Unbelievable. You never think.
What are the odds?
Right. Yeah. I've seen people lose one wing, and it's actually happened to me. My one of my very first development aeroplanes, stress testing it, which is what we're supposed to do. It was always the intention: go out and fly the aeroplane until you find the point of failure. And I reached that point and threw a wing off and managed to get it back down on the ground, which I thought would never happen.
Get that on camera. He is not kidding. It sounds like it wouldn't be possible, but yeah, he landed an airplane that lost both of its wings. I am not kidding. You guys are gonna have to wait for an episode of On the Fly to see that one, because we did record it.
Yeah, so that was my favorite crash. Got away with it. And the plane is totally flyable, not a mark on it, so. More luck than judgment.
My saddest crash is Horizon RC Fest, Ring of Fire. Second lap through with a Mini Apprentice right into the Ring of Fire. It's literally one of the first big crashes. The reason it was sad is I wanted to keep flying, and then I just had to kind of stand there and watch.
Yeah.
So that was definitely my saddest. The plane's fixed. I actually gave it away, but yeah, that was definitely the saddest one.
All right, well, we've been able to
Pete.
My favorite crash?
Yeah.
My most favorite crash?
Can't use the same one for both questions.
No,
and you can't use a quad crash because that's just.
See, and that's what I was going to use, so I won't use it, but I'll say it.
You can.
When I hit Rory in the back with my 7-inch quad going full speed, and he did not have a mark on him.
Yeah.
Wow.
That one was amazing. We were at RC Fest.
To be fair, to make things crystal clear, it was all his fault.
He was on the wrong side of the flight line. Yeah. It was in the dark. Drew wants to know how he can get a job working for us.
We have open job reps at the moment.
Seriously, I started in product support. I was a phone rep for a really long time, about 2 years, and was able to move into this position here. So yeah, Drew, you want to move to Champaign and get a job with Horizon Hobby? We do have positions available.
Go to our website, scroll down to the bottom of the page, there'll be a tab you can click on that says careers. Click that and apply away.
I didn't even start, I just turned up and they let me in.
Yeah, you don't really need to
You're
go
the guy
through
from
little...
that YouTube video.
Yeah.
Hawker Hunter guy wants a job.
No, Hawker Hunter guy's here.
Your views are going up as we speak.
They're not my views. There's somebody who posted it without my permission.
Brought up a bad son?
Yeah. No, to be fair, he asked, you might be posting this video, and I said, I'd rather you didn't. Week later. Thanks for asking.
He did ask.
Right?
Knew I should ask for forgiveness.
Uh-huh.
Now, what about some cool flying moments There's one I can think of on a, on the fly before RC Fest, I believe. Allie and Pete were sitting in the boat pond, and Allie actually landed a plane. I can't remember what plane it was, but it was
Carbon Cup, man.
Yeah, he's like Carbon with Cup. Floats.
Yeah.
And he landed in this little pond that might not look little on camera, but when I saw that, I was like, wow, that was pretty cool.
Yeah, Carbon Z Cup usually can't get into that small amount of water, but somehow Allie was able to pull it off. I think it just bumped the end of the other end of the pond, right?
We have had a lot of fun. And On the Fly series has been incredible for me, because when I think in the short time we've been doing it, how much fun we've had. And I know we keep going on about it, but just yesterday we were at the field, and I don't think I've laughed that hard and screamed like a girl that much. In a long time, and this is all on the fly related. So yeah, I think for me, there's no, I mean, I've been doing this all my life, and I've traveled around and done a bunch of different flying, so I'm very fortunate in that sense. But out and out fun the last year of doing OTFs. We've done some projects where you think, that's just daft, that's never gonna work, it's work. Flying from the boat.
Yeah.
Summer, last summer was incredible.
Yeah, on the float.
There you go.
And yeah, for me, flying behind a boat with a drone, that's an all or nothing scenario. You know, you don't get to just crash and be fine. You know, there's an expensive GoPro on there, lots of tech that you don't want to lose in the water. And it would have. We didn't, you know, put any floats or anything on the quads or the airplanes or anything when we were out on the boat, and just had a blast when we were successful.
You're just that good. What was your most fun you had flying an RC plane?
Most fun I've had flying an RC plane. Well, since I'm relatively new, pretty much anytime I fly one of our new planes, and it's probably something a little above my skill level, I should preface this. A lot of the times when I say this is my first time flying an EDF jet, legit is the footage of my first time doing something. So a lot of times when I'm able to bring that in and land or leave bits on the runway like I maybe did with the F-15 one time, that's really fun. As far as funnest, like, period was probably actually when we were at the Badlands.
I was going to say that, the turbo timber at the Badlands.
In Attica, Indiana, which is where Axial Fest is, well, Axial Fest Midwest is held this year. Just flying in that environment, it was almost like a real, like, Northwestern type, like, STOL type backdrop. And just getting silly, flying through gaps that you probably shouldn't. And
you guys were able to pull down some really cool shots. If you guys haven't seen the Horizon Hobby Insider episode of Kyle and, oh, well, I guess... Say. It was just Kyle out at the Badlands with the turbo
was videoing as well.
Yeah.
I just didn't know if I could say that out loud.
Yeah,
I guess we're past that. You're no longer permanently tower, right?
Alec, got a question. What's with the FMS glider above you?
Oh my. The Fox?
Yeah.
Yeah, my favorite. Foamy for last year. FMS sent one across to us. About 18 months ago now to test. I saw it in the foam area and basically made it my given task to make sure that ended up with me. I'm a big fan of gliders. If it's got a motor on it, even better. And if it's aerobatic, oh my gosh, that's the whole series of perfection. And I saw that and I was like, I reckon that might be a bit of fun. So I started playing with that. Gave feedback to FMS. And then when they became production available, I ordered one. And decided to put a different livery on it. Just wanted a different color scheme than anyone had. Cali Graphics supplied the NASA stickers. I actually borrowed the idea off a chap in Arizona. One of our team guys, Tony Quist, was good enough to send me a picture of one of his friends who had done the same color scheme. And I won't claim credit. I just simply borrowed that scheme and it's something that comes out. We use it for smart ESC testing, but yeah, it's a personal toy.
So, Ali, this is actually a funny question, because the answer to your question is actually in the frame.
Yeah.
So if you could modify any plane to have floats on it that wasn't meant to, what plane would it be? Oh, and man. I'll just do this and then leave it right there for a second. And if you can find the plane in the shop, then you have your answer.
Anything that's not meant to have floats on, it's been a bit of my MO for a while at work. I would mess around, particularly when the foam guys weren't looking, and bolt a set of floats to one of their development airplanes. So the V-22 Osprey, I will say, looks amazing on floats. If anyone in the military is listening and would like to go to the trouble of making real one on floats, you can give me credit. I don't even need the credit. Just do it. But yeah, anything that's not meant to have floats.
That makes it all the more fun, right?
Yeah, I'd like to one day put a jet on floats. I'm not sure how the practicality of that would work out, but yeah, give it a go.
So we got a kind of a technical question on YouTube, and Gary might want to get in on this one.
Gary's the man for tech.
Some guy wants to know, how are you going to get a longer flight time on a stock E-Flight Extra 300
Gary.
Using a 4S 3300
Gary.
35C LiPo? He's only getting 4 minutes of flight time.
There's this left stick on the
ladies and gentlemen, welcome to my world.
You can go to a smaller prop.
A smaller prop? Okay.
Yeah, you're not going to have the same amount of power, of course, but a smaller prop will do it.
And how much more flight time are we talking about a smaller prop, Gary?
It depends on how small you go on the prop.
Okay.
I believe that comes with a 13.7 to begin with, and maybe a 13.6. So I drop at least an inch, maybe 2 inches in diameter. That should give you 30-40% more flight time flying at the same rate you do now.
You got done with Velcro straps?
There we go.
Yeah, I'm trying to decide whether or not we can fit a bigger pack in here. So if we can fit the 6S 5000s or 4000s, lose the tray.
Tell you what, these push rods are no joke. These things are bulky.
Well, the 3mm ones?
Yeah.
Yeah, we do 2 and 3mm, so. Can we fit 6S 5000 in there?
Allie?
Yes.
Billy D is here.
Oh my gosh, here we go. Things are going to get ugly now.
He wanted me to let you know that he's here.
Okay. I'm worried now. We should all be worried. Nah, Billy's a good guy. Billy's a longtime friend from the jet community.
Allie, I didn't know you spoke German.
Yeah. All the languages. I do all the translation and everything.
The book's open in the German section.
The pictures are in English. Always.
I don't want to speak too soon, but it's almost like we're almost towards the end. We got a couple push rods to install. Allie's finishing up on the power system here.
Just trying to route. I can fit a 5000 in there with the wing on. That's the important bit. Lovely. I'm happy about that.
Clevis on both ends.
Yeah, a little bit of Loctite or Sino on that just to stop it unwinding. Sino would do everything.
That prop looks small in the back, but now that it's on the rotor, it looks plenty big.
What size prop are we using?
Let me take a look.
14x8.5 electric.
Which is the recommended. You just went with the recommended setup.
Yeah, it says a completion guide on the website, I'm assuming.
Yep. Yes, indeed. We are deviating a little bit from the completion guide with motor and battery recommendation. It'll be interesting to see what sort of amps we're drawing, and that's one of the really cool things about fitting the smart speed controller is that we can have live telemetry data coming, telling us what amps, what RPM, what battery voltages, everything. We just did a video on the OTF series where we fitted a smart speed controller to the 20cc Hangar 9 Mustang and tailored the prop and motor spec basically to get a top speed up from 90 miles an hour, which is what it was factory stock, and we got it to 150 150.4 or something like that. And all of that we did using the data from the smart ESC. So I'm hoping we can do the similar type thing here with the later videos when Carl gets his airplane set up for insider videos. This will be a perfect platform for him to show those watching the Insider series how the data comes through live.
What's up, Cam?
Cameron Wilson, Chili Cook-Off Champion 2020. Come on.
Mr. Smart.
Look at him.
my head that flip.
We'll call him Mr. Smart.
Yeah, ladies and gentlemen, anyone watching and wants to know who the smart is behind smart technology, it's not this guy. He just does the hard work.
The smart model.
Is that a new release that?
Ooh.
Or is that a future release?
Testing. I shouldn't even be showing
you. Oh, good work, bud. You didn't see that. Yeah, well done.
Go on about what you're doing.
Chili champion.
See you, Cam. See you.
Thanks for coming.
So Chris, unfortunately, just pointed out that we didn't hit our two-hour deadline.
Four-hour deadline was the actual initial, yeah. We booked this out for 4 hours, so.
But Chris is proud of us. He says we're right at the two-hour mark. He says we're doing pretty darn good. That's my favorite part, whenever anybody walks through and they're trying to sneak through.
Right? Like, hey, what are you doing? Gotta call them out.
Again, to explain to some of you guys who obviously don't know how the layout works, we are in the condos. We call it the John Doe's or John Dominium, which is a structure which is actually on the other side. John Adams is our the boss of the condominium area. So
director,
technical director, long-term Horizon employee, the brains behind a lot of the Spectrum technology. So yeah, I lovingly know this as the John Dominium. It's a structure which is about.
You just did that. Block long, I would say.
Block long. How far away from the main building?
Say 200 about 200 yards, yeah.
Okay, so 200 yards away from the main building. Now, we don't take this personally that they keep us in this separate outbuilding and nobody pays any attention to us, but yeah, it has been on fire once, put out by this guy, so it's more of a safety thing.
Ali saved the day.
Right? But no, we work in a separate entity. So when you see people walking in and out, they're generally going to the third cube set along with us, which is the testing area. So all our electronics testing is done out here. So smart technologies, servos, receivers, are all done by our work colleagues at the end there. So yeah, that's I guess what Cameron was doing here with that charger.
6S 5000 fits?
6S 5000 fits.
Get the shoehorn.
No.
That's
what these are for.
What battery do you use in yours, Gaz?
6S 5000.
Oh, perfect. There you go. If it's good enough for the Gaz, it's good enough for me. Receiver, I'm ready.
Woo-wee.
Got an RX in.
A little wrinkly.
Talk about Gaz like that. Sorry about it. So inconsiderate.
Bad.
No.
So I'll put, what do you want to do, 10 to 1 odds that the motor's spinning the right way?
Forgot about that.
9 to 1.
Gem.
No, there's a cool trick to that. When you install a new electric motor, you plug all the wires in and then you reverse two of them before you ever fire it up. So I guarantee you it'll all be
big rookie mistake there, guys. On a serious note, I should not have done this. Should not have put the prop on until I'm 100% sure everything's set up.
Well, now that I've reminded you, you're back to being a responsible modeler.
We're about to say adult, man. So yeah, we're going to go with the 637. 637T, new all singing, all dancing. I don't even think it's released yet, so.
The all singing, all dancing.
Yeah, huh?
Lots of bells and whistles.
Oh, all of them.
Gary's over here centering servos with the smart checker, even though I already centered them.
Hey, it's better to.
I know. Well, they weren't quite right.
Measure twice, got once, right?
It has life.
It has life.
I tell you, with all of that technology.
Ready? This label needs to spin that way. Yeah?
Yep.
What's the verdict?
Oh!
Hey!
Come on, Pete!
Now I've got to unbuild the aeroplane.
So, did you already put the battery tray in?
No, I've gone no battery tray.
Okay, so
the reason why I've gone no battery tray is I put in secondary mounts when I developed it for the bigger batteries.
Beautiful.
With the battery tray, the 5000 wouldn't come in and out this way. I'd have to take the wing on and off for the battery tray system.
So now you can actually slide it through the front hatch, right?
Yes.
So now all Ali has to do, guys, if you're not familiar with this, if you're watching a build process, you're probably very familiar with it, but all he has to do to reverse that motor direction is switch any two ESC wires. Any two ESC, do you take your pick, dealer's choice?
Nah.
You switch two of them.
Yeah, the ones which are most easily accessible.
Yeah, those are the two that he switches.
It's got to come out.
Go one, two, forward.
Yeah, you got to go one, two, the other
That's
way.
That's fine, all right. We're good.
It's going to have differential all over it.
It's good. It needs differential.
No, I mean...
For a clean roll.
The movement will not be correct. Is that better?
Yep, done. Nailed it.
One's forward, one's rearward.
There you go. See? Differential. Perfect. You're welcome.
It's four screws. Cars.
Huh?
Keep them happy.
Oh, come on. Now we've already been busted on going over the 2-hour time limit. I still got to set this thing up.
I'm waiting for it to start snowing.
Oh, if it snows, I'm not going out there in the snow.
Uh-oh. What's the matter?
We still have this one, right?
That's what I was just looking at.
I got too small a driver.
Is that hangar 9?
Yes.
Yeah.
We did?
It says it got interrupted. Okay. Hmm. But it's loading right now.
Yeah, maybe it's bad coverage?
Says it should resume.
Oh, your phone's turning on right now.
Perfect. Yeah. Good thing it was plugged in, Pete.
It was plugged in.
I just saw you plug it in, though.
I unplugged it and plugged it back in to see if that was it.
Oh.
Which it was. So, yeah, we'll get back to the hangar 9 feed here in just a moment, guys. Sorry about that.
Steven's asking if he heard that there's smart technology in BECs now. I don't know that there is.
I mean, they have a BEC within the electronic speed controller that has the smart technology. But yeah, no standalone BECs at this moment.
I like to put two in first before I start. One down.
Okay, spinning the right way.
It is, you're it.
Thanks.
No problem.
Now, we're going to set this up on the 20.
The prop off.
Alright, so what?
We're going to set this up on the iX20 for now.
iX20 for now because it's what I've got at hand. It's my radio and it gives Kyle an excuse to try and get one as a development and as a work tool. Kyle's boss, if you're listening, he needs an iX20. And yeah, it's got the forward programming, which is reasonably easy to use for me. I've not set up forward programming on another radio yet, so I'm familiar with this system.
Nice.
Now, here's a question for you. Do you want... Oh, I'm not even going to ask you. Sorry.
Yeah, he's not flying it today, Alex.
No, I mean for future. I was going to ask him, does he want separate aileron servos or a Wiley? I'm going to go separate because we can then play around with Flaperon.
Ooh,
we
yeah.
Me, for him to play with.
You're welcome, Carl.
No mention.
So, Ali, I have actually heard people say that Flaperon in certain instances could be not so great for an aileron. A wing? Yeah. What type of situations is that? I just heard it. I didn't know why or what the rhyme or reason for that was.
So, hold on a second. Let me get these extensions. Are we out 6 inches?
No, there's a bunch over here.
Oh, he's got a couple right here, buddy.
There's two, please.
Yep.
Yeah, I just got... 3 6
So Flaperon, for those that aren't aware, it's sort of the secrets in the title, it's when the ailerons also double up, multitask as flaps. So they will droop as flaps, but then work independently in opposites as ailerons. I have mixed opinions on them. Whilst it does increase the wing camber, mm-hmm. the wing shape, which is an increased lift, which is what flaps meant to do. It does also reduce the roll authority because you've not got as much upward moving aileron.
Okay.
And it's the bone of conjecture here is it does induce what we call wash in at the tip. Now wash in, without going into massive in-depth, is wash out where the ailerons go up a little bit or uh-huh. the tip curls up, is generally what we put into an aeroplane wing structure to make it more friendly around the stall.
Okay.
We're trying to make the tip stall after the root.
Yeah.
So if you ever hear the term tip stall,
yeah.
you know, departs from controlled flight, it's where this part of the wing is stalling first.
Okay.
So by introducing wash out, you negate that. You make this part stall. So it means a cleaner stall. The airplane will stall like this, as opposed to, have you ever seen a plane where it stalls like that?
Oh, yeah, yeah. And that's funny. And it totally makes sense, because when the situation where you would actually use clapeyrons, which is on an approach, that may not be the most ideal configuration for the wing while you're approaching,
and
right?
Every airplane is different, Pete. You know, like a full span aileron where it runs right to the tip is obviously different to this airplane, where we have a piece of the wingtip which is static and not moving. So
nice.
I have flown this airplane on flaperon, and whilst it doesn't make it, you know, detrimentally horrible, it doesn't make the stall super aggressive, it also doesn't change the flight profile that much, because it's quite lightly loaded, very thick wing section, you're not struggling for lift. So
okay,
where flaperon will come in handy is if you've got like a jet, like an F-16, say, and if it was a bit porky and it was a little bit heavy and it came in a bit fast, you wanted to slow that down a bit. One of the ways is generate more lift.
Yeah,
one of the ways to do that is flaperon.
Perfect.
But if I only have two ailerons and I want to use flaperons, but I don't want the negatives of flaps, I'll use spoilerons, like I've set this one up for now.
Yeah, so it'll
moving them up.
That I'm familiar with, because it spoils the lift, right? So
it changes. It changes the angle of attack of the wing and where the wing wants to fly, so the plane comes in more nose high.
Okay.
So it's like an air brake all over the place.
Very cool. Very
A plane like this will touch down the tail wheel first every time with spoiler on.
That's right.
And you don't get the adverse yaw that you get with flaperons.
Kyle, did we get the Hangar 9 stream back up?
Yes.
Cool. Sorry about that, guys. We did have a cell phone that died in the middle of our lives, so that's back up and rolling if you guys want to see the Hangar 9 feed again.
So
just
Chris said he's got his electro stick set up with flaperon, so he can do nice tight touch and goes.
Yeah, there is that. You can. One of the mixes I'll set up for Kyle is what I call a snap flap, which is where with elevator, the ailerons will drop as flaps, and what that does is it increases the lift, increases the agility, decreases the turning circle. So, I've put the 637 receiver in on a thick layer of double-sided tape. Primary reason for that is because it gives some insulation between the airframe structure and the receiver. Because it has a gyro system, AS3X, mounted inside, and we are going to use it, if I can get this thing through, that vibration proofing is very much worth doing. Because any translation of vibration through the airframe to the receiver can affect the gyro system negatively. And now what I'm doing is just putting a loose-ish zip tie on top. That's the belt and braces approach. Although it's held in quite well with the double-sided tape, never really rely on it, especially neat on top of balsa that will ply like that. Because what can happen is temperatures go up, the tape softens, the tape comes off. If the receiver comes loose, because the gyro is built into the receiver, it can be bad days, because the receiver doesn't know it's loose, it just knows it's moving, and trying to counteract with gyro inputs, which, makes for very interesting, not
so
nice flying.
Drew is asking if you recommend flaperons or a 70mm F-16.
Drew, you should check out the 8S F-16 episode of On the Fly, and you'll see that we actually love flaperons on that system, and he actually set them up negative too, so you could get some really good inverted high alpha too, right?
Yep. Yeah, we played a lot with flaperons on the airplane. It was fun.
So definitely not something that's needed on the airplane. The airplane flies really well as is, but if you did want to add in the flaperons on the F-16, it does handle it really, really well. Oh, the most important part here.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Is that wing done?
Yeah.
I'll let him off. I was going to say, if he's putting stickers on before that wing is done, I will not be amused.
Lior says this is a lot of guys for a 40-size bird.
It's not a lot of guys for a 40-size build that you're trying to get done in under 3 hours.
I mean, there's only like 2.5 guys building.
Yeah, yeah, really.
It was just an excuse to get us all out of work, really.
You can guess who the half guy is.
Friday afternoon.
Question is, Carl, where are we going to go and fly this? And do we need to fly it to put closure to this video?
Yes.
I was going to ask the people watching if they needed to see it fly, or can we just postpone it?
Because, I mean, technically speaking, the plane's done right now, right?
It's done. Yeah.
I just don't think Ali wants to go out in the cold right now.
Well, I don't want to go all the way to the flying field in the cold right now, no.
Do you have an elevator mix in with the four flaperons? So we had Steve asked if you do you add down elevator when you're using the flaperons like you would with flaps?
If it needs it, which it probably will. So I have a thing called flight conditions set, so I can program a mix or put a trim in as I'm flying in between each flight condition. So as my flaps go from here to here to here, I can retrim the elevator and not affect the trim in the other stage. Like when the flaps are up, the trim is different to when the flaps are down. I don't think I remember a time of ever flying an airplane with flaps where it hasn't caused a pitch change. Because if you think about what flaps are doing, which is completely changing the camber of the wing, the shape of the wing, it's very unlikely that you're not going to need an elevator mix. So yeah, be ready to put some elevator mix in. The UltraStick manual has the numbers on what mix to put in, and that's a rough guide, but I still recommend the flight condition. If you have it built into your radio, it's a really useful device that allows you to trim instantly. You know, you don't have to land and put in another mix and go, okay, I think it was that way, I think that's enough. You just go, beep, 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 done, land, fly.
So we got quite a few people saying we should fly it.
Oh, jeez.
Chris right. says go ahead and take it in the parking lot or the car park in Allie's.
Car park, yeah.
Yeah, this is a lot of an airplane for a busy car park, so I don't know, we'll see. If Allie's got an idea where we might be able to fly it, we'll think about it.
So for this one, it doesn't matter which way these go, but in future, you're going to have to mark them up.
Right.
Okay? Are we? Are we going to fly out the back?
You're going to fly.
All we're going to do is prop hang it if we do anything.
This is amazing. First thing he does, prop hang.
Well, that's all we've got a choice of doing, I think.
Right, that's all we have room for.
Oh, you don't have flapper on wing type set up. Your transmitter probably. And they're in 2 and 6?
I think I'm...
Look at Gary go. Yes, Paul, the battery is charged.
Hold that, please.
Oh, it's not powered
up. Hold the control surface or just the wing?
Just the wing, please.
Oh, Steve said Allie's a wuss.
Hey, that's the truth.
Let's go out in the car park and fly.
Is that not working? Is there an extension lead from here to here?
Yep. No,
that's the servo lead.
Drew, we would go out to the field, but unfortunately, that's a good 20 minutes away.
He didn't say our field, he just said a field.
That's true. We are in Illinois, we got plenty of cornfields around.
So, as always, you know, no build can go perfectly. Oh, well, never mind. It's fixed.
No, that was just testing.
No. So he has dual aileron set up on this, like we had said before. We wanted to do a flaperon setup on it.
Wow. Oh, you're not flipping.
So he's just setting it up so that's working properly. Because right now, I think for a second there, we only have one aileron. So we definitely need to fix that. Need more than one aileron for successful flight. Well, I mean, not absolutely.
Define successful.
Nice. Yeah, exactly.
You don't even need wings to fly.
Which is the sunset one?
Drew's pretty adamant about us flying it. He said corn makes a really soft landing.
Oh. Corn?
Yeah.
We're nowhere near corn.
Tom would know about the beans.
I know dirt makes a soft landing.
Yeah, nice, freshly tilled
dirt.
Let's put it on 5. Hey. And get some funk going on with P mixing.
I think you can change the port in the 637. You don't have to.
In what?
Do the D-mix.
There you go. There you go. Make it happen, guys.
Have you got throttle cut on here?
Probably, yeah. No, I have, definitely. Guys is the man when it comes to 637. This is a new receiver that it's my first experience with. As Craig pointed out, I don't even think it's been released as yet. Gaz has used it in some of his features.
Don't say that because I've seen this, but I've never...
Okay, worst case, I can do it on a P-Mix.
Looks like we did get one sympathetic vote. Looks like our friend Robert says, wait for a nice day before
you go out. This is a nice day for us here right now.
You don't have this set in developer mode, so I don't have access to all the menus. This is like it would come out of the box.
Yeah, this is stuff. Yeah. Okay, so what you're saying is P-Mix or... Channel sign, in fact.
Yeah, channel sign.
So we're doing it for view.
Chris is not on our side, Pete. He said one aileron's enough.
Yeah. It is enough. But
Channel Assam does it without doing anything else. Yeah.
How many viewers do we have right now?
We're at 45 on Horizon Facebook, 38 on YouTube, and 16 on Hangout.
Good. Thank you guys for sticking with us.
Yeah.
I know a couple of you have been watching the whole thing.
And even the right way, I love it. Right, pop the wing on, please, Carl.
What battery did you put in your size?
5,000. Okay. Can you set up Ogs 2,
yep,
which is E, as a gain, and give me 3 gains, please? I love it. Love having the gas.
So, what did we forget to do is the question.
Oh, we'll find out.
Switch prop E.
Type.
Are we going spinnerless? We are, aren't we?
For I like guy. Just the prop nut.
Yeah,
it good.
Looks leaner than this. Mm-hmm. More retro.
Yeah.
Spinner does come included in the kit, by the way, just in case anyone's wondering. And I'm sure Carl will fit the spinner when we are not 3 o'clock on a Friday afternoon.
As long as it survives the maiden flight, right?
It's not a flight, dude. It's like.
Alright.
We've got behind the condos. I'm not flying in the parking lot. There's a little bit of grass behind the parking lot, which I might be able to get a prop hang and a Harrier. And I haven't even set it up on
Is it Ox 3 that you want?
Ox 2, please.
Ox 2, okay.
Are we going to iron it first?
No.
Yeah, iron.
I'm super
It's stupid. Actually, honestly, it's very tight for it being straight all box. Like opposed to the carbon cub.
Yeah, all ARFs, I don't care who it's from. It's not how the covering's applied. It's to do with the moisture in the wood. And you think these are built in the Far East, so when they come here, they have a natural moisture in that wood, which will seep out. So the wood literally expands and contracts between Far East, container ship, Illinois. There's a fair bit of temperature and humidity difference, so you will get some wrinkling in the film.
Carl's right. I'm really impressed.
It's exceptionally, really.
With UltraCoat, the good thing is with it, you can shrink that with a heat gun or a heat iron. I will say a tip, definitely when you're ever doing any sort of covering work. I mean, we touched on this in the insider video on the carbon cup. Before going at this with heavy heat, like a heat gun, you want to make sure you have the right heat gun. Your industrial type home paint strippers will burn a hole straight in this. The modeling type heat guns are much lower temperatures. But do run a heat iron, preferably with some sort of sock or a pad on it, just to seal the edges. So this stripe here is a great example. That would be applied at the factory as a dividing, you know, decorative line between the orange and white, and it would just be put on relatively quickly. If I went at that with high heat, it will most probably pull in and distort. So get your heat gun and shrink it down. Shrink down all the edges before going at it with high heat.
Heat gun or the iron?
Iron for the sealing the edges.
Yep. You just said gun.
Yeah, sorry. and then heat gun to shrink and get wrinkles out. Good man, look at that, guys done.
You flip them and see your numbers.
Yep.
You see the numbers, 40, 50, 60.
1 second, let's have a quick look and see the directions right. High is high, yeah?
Yeah, yep.
Awesome.
Are they working?
Oh. Is there an apply? Do you have to apply?
Yeah.
So are we forward programming this right now?
We are.
Oh.
Excuse me. It's the longest I've ever been off my phone.
Yeah.
Somebody was actually calling stuff. That's my mum telling me to get off Facebook Live.
That'll be fine.
I think I did catch that my mom was watching for a little bit.
Aww.
I'm sure she didn't stay on for this long, but she did.
Hey, Mom!
Lior's asking, what is the plane above the P-47?
FMS Fox, 3-meter Fox glider.
You can rewind the live later, and we had, had a little chat about that airplane.
Probably
for
30 minutes ago or so.
Yeah.
Yeah, so again, if you're just joining us and you're wanting to watch, I'd hate to say the whole thing, but maybe you will. Once these lives end, give
you know
Facebook.
I don't think I went high enough on the throttle. And you've
No, you don't have to do that.
No?
Give Facebook a little while to process the video, and then these will
be. You need to come out. You're in.
Yeah.
It's still in.
These videos will be live, not live, but they'll be, you'll be able to watch them after the fact.
There we got some control surfaces working.
I see the rudder working.
ASX.
Elevator.
So right now we're testing AS3X just to make sure it's correct in the right direction.
I can't tell if aileron. Yep.
Ailerons are wrong.
Yeah, ailerons are chasing the wrong way.
Good job. It's antennas back, guys. If you're wondering about orientation, it's label up antennas to the tail.
Ali, Chris wants to know if you're going to Jets over Kentucky this year.
Yes. All being well, if unless work want me somewhere else, I will be going. It's one of the must go tos on my event calendar.
Chris on Facebook wants to know if you can forward program with the iX12 or just the iX20.
iX12 is forward program?
Yes.
With the latest
it's any,
firmware.
Any Gen 2, right?
Yeah.
Gotta go and update it.
So they just released a big update for a lot of radios probably 2 weeks ago. So just update your radio and you're gonna unlock the smart stuff and forward programming capabilities if the model is able to have it.
Let's just crank the gains way up so we can actually see to begin with.
Okay. That's fine.
You know what I mean?
Janko wants to know if we're gonna test the CG at all.
Uh-oh.
Tested? Slightly no.
Just the way we like
it. I don't mean to be flippant, but it's an airplane that, one, I've flown many times before, obviously, with development and demoing and so forth. It's a stock setup. Also, it's a super forgiving airplane. It's a conventional layout, straight Hershey bar wing, reasonably decent tail moment arm. And to give you an idea, when I was testing from memory, I tested with a center of gravity that went from here, which is the furthest forward by memory, it's about two fingers, and then all the way back beyond half. It was flyable beyond half, which, you know, some people may not believe, but it was very flyable. It was just a little bit pitch sensitive, particularly when I came into land. So I'm not too worried about center of gravity.
Yep.
So, once this is finished, do you think we can maybe sneak out back for just a second?
I'll try and give it a quick harry around. The only problem I've got is it's a test flight. We're using a motor and power system, which is slightly different than stock. We want to get more power out of it, so I'm a little bit mindful of that. I'm also mindful is it's not the ideal flying space.
Okay. So if it doesn't go perfectly?
If the boss wants us to fly out the back, we fly out the back.
All right. So to do that, I don't want you guys rushing off just yet, but you will have, if you guys are watching on YouTube, you will have to jump over and join us on our Facebook Live, either from Hangar 9 or Horizon Hobby, because unfortunately the really nice camera that you guys are really enjoying watching from is static. It can't leave the room. So we are going to have to go to either the Facebook Live on Horizon Hobby or the Facebook Live on Hangar 9 to see the rest of this. Yes. That'll be a few minutes from now.
Yeah, so if you're on Facebook, you're good to go. You don't need to change anything. If you're on YouTube, jump over, you know, here in the next 5-10 minutes.
Probably. Once you see us walking out the door, maybe jump over to Facebook.
Right, Carly, if you say go, we go.
Yeah.
Okay. Do me a favor.
Yes. That's what the people want to see!
We got a smart battery checker anywhere?
Yes, we do. Gary just stole it.
Can we, just check the battery status? I don't want to go trying to harry around with a battery that doesn't have charge in it.
Yep. Is it EC3 or IC5?
Five.
Yeah, lead.
Got it.
Nope.
Yep.
Okay. Although.
Oh, you're gonna have to go. There you go.
Look at that. Double fisting.
Yeah. I've got two drinks, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah. So 2.5 hours, by the way.
I'm proud of that.
Not bad.
I'm sure if we'd have focused a bit more.
We've had a couple in-studio lives that felt like they were 2.5 hours.
96% we're good.
None in particular.
Oh, Max.
You know what? Chris Langley just put up a very good point. He said, why not check the voltage on an iX20? I don't know if
No, I haven't done autoconfig.
Yeah. So after he would have ran the autoconfig, then yeah, he would have been able to just switch right over to the telemetry page on the radio and been able to see it from there.
Whilst we're there, we do an autoconfig and get the telemetry up. Clear prop.
Pete, you tightened that one bolt, right?
Oh, which bolt?
The main bolt.
You glued that one in, right?
I think so. Yeah, I don't know. We'll see.
There you go. That's armed.
Gary's saying we should do this every day.
Gary who writes.
No, we got Gary Burt.
Yeah. Okay, we're good, we're good.
The suspense.
25 volts. RPM is good.
Jim said send it.
Right.
Oh, okay.
Now we've got a slight problem. Yeah, if you could. One sec, watch out, guys.
We are going to be traveling through a room that is for our eyes only.
My eyes are.
Yeah. That's. You can't. Are the lights off or the lights on?
You're gonna have to turn the camera
on. Oh man, you guys can see none of this. Sorry about this.
A little bit developing the stuff. Ready? Stay?
Yep. Nobody gets to see how we make this.
Stay tuned.
Look at that!
Oh man, that's an awesome plane.
Careful how quick you turn those
over, yeah.
It survived! Alright guys, we're gonna let you go. If you missed the maiden flight, jump over to YouTube or jump over to Facebook, what am I talking about, and watch it. And again,
just
thank you for joining.
Yeah, there it is!
It survived!
No damage, a little bit of grass.